The little brown jug. Oh, how I love thee. And that old refrain has special meanings for football players from Minnesota and Michigan. Coming up, the 71st time that the Wolverines and the Golden Gophers have battled for this famed old football trophy. From Memorial Stadium in Minneapolis, Minnesota, ESPN presents the Battle for the Little Brown Jug, the Wolverines of Michigan versus the Golden Gophers of Minnesota. College Football 81 is brought to you by Owens Corning Fiberglass Corporation, makers of Owens Corning Pink Fiberglass Insulation, and by Natural Light, the beer with a taste for food. Around the Big Ten, it's always been known as the Old Brick House, and it's the scene of Minnesota's home games, and today, a very big one with the Wolverines of Michigan. Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Thacker. Delighted to be here for this traditional battle, and with me, the former great quarterback of Notre Dame, Terry Hanratty, and what a beautiful day in Minneapolis.
Jim, who'd you think Minneapolis Halloween day that it's going to be 65 degrees? That's what it is today, and so it's going to be gorgeous for football.
Beautiful sound, and what a game we have, a very crucial game in a Big Ten race, and of course, and here comes Minnesota after a win off for Iowa, and look what it's done to the Big Ten race.
Well, in all sports, people are looking for parity, and they certainly have it in the Big Ten. Normally, you get Ohio State and Michigan at the end of the year battling for the Big Ten, but now you have seven teams that are mathematically still involved in the race.
Two of them come in this week and one loss, five others with two, and among those are Michigan and Minnesota. So it is a very crucial game for both these, but especially this year. And let's find out how Bud Wilkinson sees this great matchup for the Wolverines and the Gophers. Bud?
Thank you, Jim. At the beginning of this topsy-turvy season, almost everyone picked Michigan to be the national champion. They've already lost two games. Why? Well, first, their defense has not quite lived up to expectations. They returned eight starters, but they graduated the three big play men, and then they've had a great number of injuries. Offensively, the problem has been inconsistency. They have looked awesome on occasions, but at other times, very mediocre. The play of quarterback Smith has been one of the problems. He's had a hot hand, and then he's had a cold hand. His statistics, I think, throwing the ball, reflect Michigan's problem. 45 completions out of 114 attempts, and that's just 39%, but the most important one are those seven interceptions. However, Iowa's defeat last week put Michigan back in the Big Ten title race and should help make them emotionally high for the Gophers. Minnesota has become a solid team. Defensively, they play a 4-4, four down linemen, four linebackers. They move constantly. They stunt a lot. They try to confuse the offensive blocking. They use the same theory with their offense. Multiple sets, men in motion, so the defense must adjust on every play. The key is their quarterback, Hohensee. How well he throws the football determines the success of the Minnesota attack. He's hit 85 of 174 passes, and that's 49%. That also reflects in the team statistics. Minnesota's throwing the ball for 180.4 yards per game, rushing it for 204, for a total of 384.4. The Gophers also have a weapon that is often overlooked in the great place kicking of Gallery. He's a man who puts the ball into the end zone on kickoffs, and he's made eight field goals in the last two games. Swing factors? Well, first, how high emotionally will Michigan be? Can they really reach the same peak of intensity that they did against Notre Dame? And then secondly, how well do the Gophers play defense? Can Minnesota stop the Michigan attack? It should be a great game. And now back to Jim Thacker.
Thank you very much, Bud. Well, Bo Schembechler said Michigan is ready. And the truth of the matter is, very few people ever do stop Michigan. And there are two good reasons for that, Terry, in the backfield. Two really great game backers for Michigan.
Well, they really are. And, you know, it's number 24, Butch Wolfolk, is just an outstanding tailback. And number one, Anthony Carter, is an outstanding receiver. And to have two game breakers like this on one team is just awesome for any defense to stop.
Well, both the record setters for Michigan. Wolfolk has already set the rushing record, and Carter, of course. And here are three big reasons they could do what they can do up in the line.
I'll tell you, Jim, you know, these three guys, Moransky, Paris, and Becker, they look like three condominiums in Manhattan. But, you know, they are outstanding. They're both, all three of them were all Big Ten last year, and they're looking for All-American honors this year. And to have an offensive line like this, and plus the running attack, you know, it's just an awesome thing, and I think that's what they're going to use today.
Well, Mrazek and Parris go about 275 or 280 apiece. How's that compare with the defensive ends for Minnesota?
Well, it gives them about a 60-pound per man edge on the defense, and that's just awesome power.
Well, the other side of the coin, the University of Minnesota has a couple of game breakers of their own. Outstanding players here, and especially Hoensey on the right, who's come on at quarterback and given Joe Salem just great leadership.
Yeah, Mike Hoensey is a junior college transfer, and he's completing about 50% of his passes, but he is. He's their offense, and he gets the ball to Cooper, and, you know, that's the mainstay of Minnesota's offense.
And up front, if they want short yardage, they're usually going to go to the right side.
Yeah, Dalfour and Humphreys, you know, they're comparable to what Michigan has up front. They're big guys, and, you know, they can block extremely well.
Don't you think, Terry, if Minnesota's going to have a good chance against this Michigan defense, they're going to put the ball up in the air?
I think, really, Jim, it's going to be all Mike Hoensey today. I think he has to be successful throwing the ball. I think it's going to be very tough to run against Michigan. They're a, you know, swarming-type defense. They have a lot of injuries, but they have a lot of capable people in there.
Okay, we'll see how the two coaches, Joe Salem and Bo Schembechler, feel about this traditional battle for the Little Brown Jug when we come back in a moment to Memorial Stadium. Michigan, Minnesota began playing for the Little Brown Jug in 1909 over a trophy that was left here in Minnesota by the great Fritz Kreisler. They played every fall since then. Michigan's dominated the series, winning 41 times, Minnesota 20. There have been two ties. Much of that lead carved out by Bo Schembechler teams. They've won 11 of 12 games since he took over as coach at Ann Arbor. And when this season began 2 months ago about Terry Hanratty, this game didn't really look like that much of a close matchup, did it?
Jim, at that point, Michigan ranked number one in the country, and virtually everyone thought they were going to walk away with the Big Ten. But now we see it, and there's great parity in the Big Ten, and Minnesota's right in the thick of things, and we're going to see what's going to happen today because they're both tied.
All right. Michigan, of course, maybe a little disappointed after that such high preseason rating. We asked Bo Schembechler if this is a typical Michigan team.
Yes, I think so. You know, we've played well at times. We've had some trouble at times, but we've had a lot of injuries defensively, and that's bothered us a little bit. But it's a typical Michigan team. It's been fun to coach. We played a lot of tougher teams. Maybe that's it. Or maybe we aren't quite as good as we have been in the past. But, you know, that remains to be seen. But, no, I think it's a typical Michigan team. And we're enjoying the season. We'll enjoy a lot more if we win these last four.
You have lost five or six starters on defense. But back when you ranked number one in the nation starting in, did you feel that was a fair rating at that time?
Well, our concern was defensively, Jim. And we weren't sure that we were strong enough defensively. And then even before the season started, the injuries started to hit us. And now, you know, we're without probably five starters in this game, maybe six. We have one we may not be able to start. And if that's the case, we're playing a lot of young people. But I don't feel bad about that. They're enthusiastic, and we may make some mistakes and things like that. But we'll get after them. I think it'll be a good ball game.
Well, it's a little bit different looking than Big Ten, though. It used to be you and Ohio State, and now seven teams. I guess the closest race the league's ever had. What do you think about all this balance?
Well, you know, I'd rather have it the other way, but, you know, that's I think it's great for the conference, and it's great for college football. There's a lot of enthusiasm around all of these Big Ten cities now, whereas before they were just striving for the upset of Michigan and Ohio State.
Well, I think from our standpoint, it's really good. You know, I think Michigan and Ohio State have dominated for the last 10 years, and I've felt since I've been in the league, which is just 3 years, that, you know, I still said until somebody beats those two, and when the end season's over, if they're not 1-2 and somebody cracks those two, we're not going to know. But I believe that the other eight teams have gotten better. All of us have gotten better, and our biggest problem was we kept beating each other, and also all of us ended up mediocre. So now we're getting a couple more beating the Michigans, and one of them beating Ohio State. So it's added a great deal of interest as far as the Midwest is concerned, and I think from our standpoint, we're glad that we still got a chance to be in this thing.
Smokey Joe Salem, who played here under the great Murray Warmoth, and now he has come home to make Minnesota a contender as we come down closer to the opening kickoff of this game. Terry, it's rare indeed that a team can have as many as two losses and still win the Big Ten. It hasn't happened that often, has it?
No, it really hasn't. In fact, Wisconsin was the last team to win the Big Ten with two losses. And normally, I think it's said before that it was always Michigan and Ohio State playing. And in the 60s, Michigan State had great football teams. and they really dominated, and the other teams in the Big Ten just weren't competitive enough, so that's why they had very few losses.
Matter of fact, that 59 Wisconsin team's the only team ever to win the Big Ten with two league losses, and it appears there's a good chance for that to happen here today. Michigan will be wearing the white with their maize and blue with the helmet decorated that wing design that first started under Fritz Kreisler, and Minnesota will be wearing their traditional maroon and gold. And so it's a beautiful day here in Minneapolis. Here come the Golden Gophers, cheered on by a throng of over 50,000 for this crucial Big Ten game from Memorial Stadium. And what a contest we expect. And we'll be back for the opening kickoff of this game, the battle for the Little Brown Jug, in just a moment. Well, we've mentioned the Little Brown Jug, and that'll be the prize here to the winner of this game. And also on the sidelines here is Floyd of Rosedale, almost equally famous as a trophy between Minnesota and Iowa. And last week, they took this trophy down to Iowa, and they were able to bring it back home, Terry.
Yeah, it's one of the better-looking pigs I've ever seen.
I know you're thinking about barbecued ribs, but we'll let that go for the moment. It'll be Michigan kicking off. Minnesota won the toss. Back deep is Manny Henry, the freshman fullback of Evanston, Illinois. He'll start the game today at fullback. He's back there with Kerry Glenn, number 8, and Ali Hajishik will kick off for the University of Michigan, a junior from Arlington, Texas. And so it'll be Minnesota getting their first chance here. Michigan will have a pretty stiff breeze at the back for the first quarter. And the crowd roaring here now for these two traditional rivals to begin battle on what is a rare October afternoon in Minnesota. Hajishik, number 6, came in here with a slight injury, but he kicks that ball deep. It'll go past the end zone, I believe. Yep, and it'll be 20-yard line for Minnesota as Hajishik really boomed it out of there, and Minnesota will start on the offense on the touchback of their own 20-yard line, first and 10. In the backfield for Minnesota, they'll have Mike Hoynsey starting at quarterback. He is one of the key men, by the way, along with Chester Cooper, the flanker. That's great passing combination, as Cooper has set a record of almost 600 yards. And the offensive line. Here, we'll show you the offensive line starters in a moment, but now the first play of the ball game. Hoynsey, the tailback, is Frank Jacobs, who will start coming off an injury, number 40. And they give it to Jacobs. Trying the right side, not much. Maybe about a yard. Stopped around the 20-21-yard line by Al Sinchit, the nose guard, a freshman from Cleveland, Ohio, making only his second start. There's the offensive line as for University of Minnesota. And the big man is Ken Dallafiore, and Bill Humphreys playing on the right side, right tackle, and right guard. Dallafiore, 264 pounds. They just tried his side, and they got only a yard. Second down and 9. Wide left side is Ryan Weckbecker. And on the short side of the field is Chester Cooper, the big threat. Hoynsey now on second down and 9 is looking. Hoynsey, good protection. Hoynsey going to Weckbecker. Almost intercepted over here by Brian Carpenter. Carpenter, who closed in on it, as looked like Weckbecker lost his footing, Terry, at about the 30.
You know, Jim, we were down the field earlier, and, there didn't seem to be, there were a lot of guys slipping, but the field seemed to be in pretty good shape.
As the defensive line, the University of Michigan, they use a three-man line with, they use more or less of a 3-4 defense with four linebackers. Big man is Al Sinchit, a nose guard. He's the guy to watch, a rather five-man, three-man front. We'll carry that deep secondary just a moment. Third down and 9 for Hoynsey. This time he has Cooper on the left. Hoynsey going for Cooper over the middle, broken up. Chester Cooper running the middle inside route, broken up by Keith Bostic, the strong safety by Michigan. So Michigan has survived the first aerial threat for Hoynsey. It'll be fourth down and a punting situation with 9 yards to go to the 21-yard line. And now Michigan looks to get good field position. They send back receiver Tony Jackson. And in the ballgame is Paul Blanchard to do the punting. Michigan has 10 men up there close to the line. There's Blanchard, is averaging 35.4. Only Jackson, a senior from Cleveland, is waiting back for Michigan. Nope, that is Carter. Anthony Carter is back. Carter waiting. A beautiful punt taken up at 35. Carter, not much room. About a 3-yard return is all to the 38, but still, pretty good field position for the University of Michigan as they take over for the first time in the game. So we'll set the offense now for the Wolverines. We've already told you about their great 1-2 punch, but they'll start Steve Smith at quarterback, Stan Edwards, a great fullback, and with them, the great 1-2 punch, Butch Wolfolk at tailback, and Anthony Carter, number one, both primed as All-Americans. Vince Bean will be the split end, and the tight end is Norm Betts. We'll show you the line in a moment. Here comes the first play for Michigan at their own 38. Smith gives it to his fullback, Edwards, straight up the middle over the 40, maybe the 42-yard line. It's going to be about a 3 or 4 yard gain for Stan Edwards, who's already had 500-yard games, and he's shooting now for 2,000 yards. There's the offensive line for the University of Michigan as Betts, and there are the three big guys, Ed Moransky, 275, Kurt Becker, 265, and Bubba Parris, also at 275. Parris and Moransky, probably the best set of offensive tackles in the United States this year. Game is 4, second down and 6 in the 42. Gave it there with the first play, now to give us the Wolf again. Minnesota is waiting. He was hit first by Glenn Seslevich. And Seslevich, who plays the outside linebacking post for the Gophers, came in and actually threw Wolfolk for a loss of a yard. That doesn't happen very often. He just set the all-time Michigan rushing record last week when he went 3,368 yards for his career, passing up Rob Lytle.
I'll tell you, Jim, when you play a 4-4 defense, you can gamble a lot with the outside linebacker, and that's exactly what Seslevich did that time.
We'll show you the Minnesota defense in a moment, but here's a key play now for Michigan, their first series. Third and 7 for Steve Smith. Harder's on the right side, the bottom of your screen. Here's Smith back, play action. Smith looking the other way. Smith running, may get the first down. He does, over the 50 to the 49. A broken play for Steve Smith with a deep receiver's cover. Jim Fonhorst putting on the pressure, but Smith broke through and picks up a key first down, the first series for Michigan. So the Wolverines marching here. There's the Minnesota defense quickly. Orgus will be the left end. Kellen, then Fonhorst, Howard, Mecklenburg, and Davis, and in the backfield, Seslevich, who just made that tackle, and there are the others, Harris, Cardelli, Pepe, and Willis. Willis is a very outstanding safety man. You'll hear from him. He has 4 of the 5 interceptions for the Gophers. First and 10, Michigan and Minnesota territory for the first time today. And again, they go to Wolfolk. Wolfolk tries the left side, cuts inside the end to the 45. Minnesota undoubtedly is going to key a little bit on Butch Wolfolk. Jim Fonhorst again went over to meet the play to make the stop. He's a senior linebacker from St. Cloud, Minnesota, coming off wrist surgery, and he's had an outstanding season. 79 tackles, which leads the Minnesota team, and he's recovered 2 fumbles. Second and 6 after an advance of 4 by Wolfolk. Now as Craig Dunaway comes in at tight end, replacing Norm Betts. For Michigan, Bo Schembechler may be sending the plays in that way, or he likes to signal. But this time, Dunaway's brought into play, and here is second down play for the Wolverines. Wolfolk again, looking for room to the right side, trying to get outside, will not. Cut down beautiful. Oh, that was a great tackle. Coming up was Harris, I think. Andre Harris, the left cornerback, met that play, and he stopped it for, again, no gain on the play, or at very least 1 yard. Penalty marker is down. There's a holding signal flashed against Michigan. Referee Richard McVay just gave the signal. The other officials are umpire Tom Manning. The headlines was Art White. The line judge, Don Langlow. The field judge is Phil Barnes. The back judge is Tom Klein. Signed here by the Big Ten. Bo Schembechler in his 19th year of coaching with 159 victories. Only Bear Bryant and Bob Blackman among the active coaches have won more. Now they're going to take the penalty, Terry.
Well, you have to take a holding penalty, Jim. 15 yards is an awful distance.
Back to the 45-yard line of Michigan.
This is going to force Michigan to put that ball up in the air. One thing, when Smith, people don't realize, you see Bo Schembechler's career record there, 159, 40, and 6, just outstanding. But Smith has 4-5 speed in the backfield, so if the receivers are covered downfield, he gets to run that ball. He's going to put a lot of pressure on the defense.
Vince Bean has come back in and split him, but Carter's on the right side. He's the guy that Minnesota must constantly double-team and watch. There you see the shifting around of the Minnesota defense. It is second down and 16 for Smith going deep down the middle for Carter. He's got it on the 35. Carter toasts the outside, taken out of bounds at 31. It'll be first down for the Michigan Wolverines. Andre Harris, the left cornerback, But he has a tremendous job trying to keep up with the elusive and quick Anthony Carter.
That's the whole thing. They tried to just put Andre Harris on him one-on-one. He gives him an awful lot of room. I tell you, you really can't do anything. You know, you have to put two men on him. You got to watch him long and short. That time, Andre Harris is one-on-one, so he's got to give a lot of room. And you're going to hit those 15 to 18 yards out all day long.
Anthony Carter had his greatest game ever against Michigan. 142 yards on 9 catches last year, including 2 touchdowns. First and 10, Michigan at the Minnesota 31. They give it to the fullback Edwards. To the left side of the open. Over the 20-yard line, he dives for 17. First to 10 again for the Wolverines. Then Cardelli made the stop. And Michigan here on its first series of the football game. Driving hard now. They're inside the 20-yard line of Minnesota. That's 3 consecutive first downs. The pass by Carter got him down deep, and Edwards got a gaping hole on the left side. Bubba Parrish probably opening up something over there in his spot as Joe Salem looks on from his sideline perch from Minnesota. Carter, the only wide out to the right side. Now here comes Dunaway in motion. They sweep the right on the option play. The pitch is off of Wolfick. He hangs on to the ball. He's driven out of bounds inside the 15. Wolfick almost fumbled that football. Andre Harris again came up to make the play at about the 12 or 13 yard line. They're going to get a gain out of it. Maybe 4 yards. It'll be second down and give them 5 yards down to the 12. Second down and 5 coming up for Michigan. Now they spot it in the 13. Second and 6. First option play we've seen today, Terry.
I think you're going to see Smith do a lot of that today. I think it really get him into the running system, because if they cover Wolfolk, he can turn upfield. And I said with that 4-5 speed, he created an awful lot of pressure on the defense.
This time they put Carter the wide side of the field out to the left. Second down play is the play action fake into the end zone to Carter over his head incomplete. Carter was running the route. Post pattern right over the middle in the end zone. Cardelli was back covering, but the pass was thrown too behind. That's been one of the problems, as Steve Smith has just been inconsistent in his throwing. You noticed something in Smith's warm-up that we might talk about, Terry, the way he dips the ball down a little bit.
One thing a quarterback can't get into the problem is once you set up the pass, the ball should never go below your waist. And he dips the ball down a little bit, and I think that's what really makes his ball tail off. You saw how high that last pass was. You really have to come over the top of the ball throw.
Third down and 6, and now here's the gift. The Wolfick, and Minnesota's waiting for him at the 15-yard line. Fred Orgas led the charge in his left end post. A junior from Brooklyn Center, Minnesota, Kevin Kellen, who plays right along beside him at left tackle, was there to help out. So we may see Haji Sheik coming here to try a field goal on fourth down. B.J. Dickey's on the field. He'll hold. And Ali Haji Sheik, who's hit only 1 of 4 field goal tries this year, will be in to try to put Michigan on the lead. It'll be a 31-yard attempt from the 21-yard line. The wind is slightly at his back. Here's the kick in the air, and it is good. Haji Sheik hits his second field goal of the year in 5 tries, his first here this afternoon. And now the score becomes Michigan 3, Minnesota nothing, as the Wolverines draw first blood in the battle for the Little Brown Jug. We'll be coming back, Minnesota, to receive the kickoff. Minnesota now will receive the kickoff. They'll send back Kerry Glenn and Manny Henry, a pair of freshmen. There's Henry, number 37. Glenn is number 8, who is to his right, or to his left. And here to kick off will be Haji Sheik. Haji Sheik has put Michigan in the lead by 3-0 on a 31-yard field goal. And the first period. Just a tremendously, what a rare day in October we have here in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Number 6, Ali Haji Sheik, father of a teacher down in Texas, third generation from Iran. And here's the deep and hands all the way to the back line. Kerry Glenn takes that ball and very wisely downs it 10 yards deep in the end zone. And for the second time, Haji Sheik puts one beyond return. And so it'll be first and 10, Minnesota, at the 20-yard line. The first time, remember, Hoynes, he tried a couple of passes, Terry. They didn't work. Do you think he's going to keep that up?
I think he's going to try to run the ball a little bit, get a little better field position. But I really have to question Michigan on the last drive, 3rd down and 6, to try to run Wolfolk down there when the real estate is really tough. You know, Smith has not been throwing the ball well, but you really have to go to the pass down there because you have Carter on the outside.
Cooper's the far side. He's the wide receiver and the deep threat. for Poinsy. Jacobs the tailback. Henry still the fullback. They pitch it to Jacobs. Jacobs trying to cut back a little, looking for an opening. Not much there. Tripped up as he dives out maybe the 22. He'll get a short gain out of it, stopped by Paul Geargash, an inside linebacker who had 10 tackles last year in the game against Minnesota, so perhaps he likes to play against the maroon and gold. Jacobs, who was injured, was a questionable starter as late as yesterday. He is the leading rusher for Minnesota this year. Completed this game with 539 yards and a 5-2 average with 8 touchdowns. Wide left now is Weckbacker, and Cooper's to the right. Second about 8 and 22. Play action fake. Here's Horns, a good time. Fires over the middle, incomplete. Intended that ball over here for Manny Henry out of the backfield. He had another man, Weckbacker, David. Brian Carpenter was covering right in the middle. Just was not a well-thrown ball.
It was not. I'll tell you, the last three passes that Hohensee has thrown, though, Jim, it concerns me as he's thrown right into the smack of that zone. Now, you really have to go outside because Michigan is collapsing. There are two safeties in the middle, and there's a lot of people in that territory, so you really have to be cautious.
Hohensee, who has thrown for over 1,200 yards this year and 10 touchdowns with 7 interceptions. Minnesota has not scored a touchdown since October 10th, and since that date, Michigan has not allowed one. 10 quarters for the Wolverines defensively. Minnesota has gone scoreless in touchdowns for the last 8 quarters. Maybe took too long. Penalty flag drop. Delay of game will cost Minnesota 5 more yards. And the Golden Gophers have put themselves deeper in a hole on their second series. They were held here by Michigan from the opening kickoff, and the Wolverines took over the ball near their 40 and drove 62 yards to score on the field goal by Hajishik. And now here's Minnesota again. You can see Mike Hohensee. They call him the Throwing Samoan. He is of Hawaiian descent. He has quite a resemblance to Jim Plunkett facially as you look at the Minnesota sideline. And Terry, there, the guy's getting the signals.
Yeah, we'll get into those signals a little bit later on here because it's really interesting how they do it.
Third and 12. Michigan on the blitz.
Watch out.
There's Hohensee going deep. He is coming for Cooper, and he is looking up. Beautiful coverage here by Marion Boddy or Bostic. Who was it? I think it was Boddy was intended for Jacobs out of the backfield. It was Marion Boddy who went back there with Jacobs and broke it up at the 45-yard line. Incomplete pass. Boy, it looked like Jacobs had a chance to catch that ball after it was deflected.
You tell all your receivers to catch the ball at the high point. You don't let the ball fall into your arms. That time Boddy, you know, hit it at the high point, but Jacobs has got to stop and go up for it.
Anthony Carter waiting. Here's Paul Blanchard. He's back in deep punt formation. There's Carter. He's always a threat to go anytime he touches the ball. Well, a nice punt into the wind by Blanchard. Carter has it on his 49. Coming toward the sideline. Looking for the block. He shoots. Cuts up to a 45-40. Carter back against the screen, but he's slowed under the 36. A nifty return, however, by the elusive Carter. And Michigan will have great field position. We'll be coming right back here to see how the Wolverines do in their second turn. It is Michigan 3, Minnesota nothing. Steve Smith back at quarterback with Wolfolk and Edwards as running backs. Dean and Carter, the wide receivers. Tight end is Norm Betts, who just shifted to the right side. It is Edwards, the fullback, countering back to the right side after a fake to Wolf that goes to the 31. Jim Fonhorst, the inside linebacker, made the stop for Minnesota, but it's to pick up a 5 for Stan Edwards, who now has passed the 2,000-yard mark in his career.
Jim, just an outstanding field position here for Michigan to put the ball up in the air. They're on about the 33-yard line. They have a lot of real estate. They have a lot of weapons, and second down and about 6 yards. You know, just a great time to throw the ball.
Well, they've got Carter on the wide side of the field. You can see Smith looking over that way. Play action. They're looking for Carter. Over the middle for Carter. Broken up. Great play by Glenn Cardelli. Cardelli, at that time, was able to stay with Carter one-on-one. Incomplete pass. It'll be third down, Michigan. Well, you called it, Terry.
The thing is, though, that Minnesota is really playing Carter for that post pattern. You saw Cardelli, outstanding defensive play there, but he's playing to the inside. Michigan's got to pick up on this, you know, fake to the inside and run to the flag. There's a lot of room out there for Carter to work on.
Well, Norm Betts has just brought the play in. They'll push him back on the sidelines, and they could be giving that word to Carter any moment. Carter's again up the wide side of the field, top of your screen. Down the bottom is Vince B. Smith's going to go again. Now Smith being chased and sacked. A rush by Mecklenburg. A big junior tackle from Medina, Minnesota, number 74, gets the first sack of the day for Minnesota. He's had that's 11th tackle this year that he's thrown backs for losses, so he really specializes on breaking through there. That was a big one.
And that's the best pass defense you can have. Have Mecklenburg break through there for the sack. Put the pressure on the quarterback.
Don Brackett in the punt from Michigan. Glenn Cardelli and Jack Schlichting are back from Minnesota. 14 is Cardelli, 27 is Schlichting. Brackett, who's the fifth leading punter in the United States, leads the Big Ten. Over 45 yards a kick, and here's one that is going to be taken on a fair catch of the seven by Cardelli. And that'll put Minnesota very back in a hole. Well, as the Minnesota offense comes out, they'll be stuck back near their goal line. We'll remind you about next week. Ohio State will be coming right in here to Minnesota, Terry. So if things stand, we'll be back here for that game. And that should be another key game, the Big Ten. Clemson at North Carolina could well decide the Atlantic Coast Conference Championship at Chapel Hill. And Baylor will be at Arkansas, where the Razorbacks are a little bit hard to figure. They'll beat Texas one week, and next week they'll come back and lose to somebody else. So that'll be the lineup for ESPN next week here on your All Sports Network. Back in a hole now from Minnesota. And they give it off to the fullback, but I don't think much Jacobs. Jacobs the tailback. Maybe he gets back the line of scrimmage, and that'll be about all. There's the signaling, Terry.
Second down and nine from 8 yard line.
1 yard gain. There are the signals, Terry, from the quarterbacks.
I'll tell you, once you have a team backed up like this, you know, it just it's such a good pressure, you know, on the Michigan defense here, because they can go all out. They realize that Minnesota's going to run the ball.
Gain of one, second down and nine for ONC. Fullback Henry, the first man, plunges up over the 10-yard line. Tony Osborne brings him down around the 11 or 12-yard line. Henry, just a freshman, moved ahead of Bob Stroup, who had been switched to tailback when they thought that Jacobs would not start the game. Now the signaling, Terry.
Okay, both the number two quarterback and the number three quarterback, they'll both give signals. That way, there's no way that Michigan can pick up on it. And, you know, they're told the first signal they give is the hot signal, which means the one the quarterback should, you know, which quarterback you should watch, either the second team or third team quarterback.
That saves the time of trying to shuttle a player in every time if you want to send the play from the sidelines. Now the give is off to fullback Henry, fighting the left side. He's not going to make the first down. Stop short of the 15-yard line. Mike Limeron, outside linebacker of Michigan, hit him. The Wolverines will get the ball again, and Minnesota's still looking for its first down of the game, as this Michigan defense has just been smothering Minnesota in the first quarter. Minnesota, Michigan leads the game by a score of 3-0. Paul Blanchard in the punt will be in, standing on his end zone, and Anthony Carter, who's a package of dynamite, is waiting for Michigan. Blanchard, a sophomore from right here near Minneapolis, from Minnetonka, actually, in the St. Paul. Good rush! They almost flag down. Roughing the kicker, Carter. That catch has no meaning because Minnesota is going to get a break on this one. Michigan tried to block the punt. Gary Burgi, I think, is the guy who ran into the punter, Blanchard, and watch it, Terry.
If you touch the ball, you can hit the kicker. You see Blanchard gets the ball away, clean kick. Now here comes the too many guys. Say, you know, it's not... No, I don't think it's very sound football to try to block a kick in the end zone like that. They're backed up like that because you're going to end up with great field position anyway. And if you do end up blocking a kick, you may go out of the end zone and you only get 2 points. You know, so get the good field position and use your explosive offense.
Jerry Burgi is the man, number 15. He's a defensive halfback from Ottawa, Ohio. And his aggressive play, and he'll never be criticized for that by his coaches probably, but there's the signal now to referee Richard McVay. It gives Minnesota its first down. It comes by penalty. Minnesota this year. There you can see they started their first three games with wins. Those were big ones before they lost to Illinois. Then they defeated Northwestern, losing to Indiana. That was a big one, of course, for them. But then the big win of the year against Iowa last week. Now Hoynsey with room. Hoynsey got a man open. Fires. It is caught by Jacobs. Out of the backfield over the 35-yard line. Paul Geergash hits him down. And that'll be the first completion of the day by Hoynsey. Frank Jacobs, who was questionable until yesterday because of a deep thigh bruise he suffered against Indiana. How'd you like that pattern, Terry?
I really liked it because what Minnesota did was they took advantage of what Michigan was giving them. They were in a deep zone, and just render your halfback out there, get him the ball, let him run with the ball, and picked up 8.5 yards on the play.
All right, second down, only about two to go here for Minnesota. This is the best field position they've had thus far. Henry and Jacobs behind Hoynsey. They give it the first guy, Henry, and he runs into a stonewall, still on his feet, and he'll be taken down for a loss. Michigan defense is really tough. Keith Bostic, a strong safety, smelled that play in a hurry and got into the act right at the line of scrimmage. And they drop Henry for a loss, and now it brings up a crucial third down play for Minnesota. The offense is yet to score a first down. They did get a break on the penalty a moment ago, roughing the kicker. Now Hoynsey has set Weckbecker to the left, and he's got his home run guy, Chester Cooper, at the short side of the field at the top of your screen. Play action, fake the fullback. Hoynsey, plenty of time. Hoynsey lobs out the right side.
Oh.
And it's caught by Jacob. Gets a throw with a 45, first and 10, Minnesota. Paul Geergash made the stop, and that ball was just laid up there for Jacobs to run under.
Now, what you're going to see, Paul Geergash, number 50, come into the play. You see him, he has great coverage on Jacobs, but it was just an outstanding throw, just laid it over his head. Anytime you can get a linebacker one-on-one with a running back, you have the advantage to lay it out there. Your running back will come up with it 9 out of 10 times.
Hoynsey, a junior college All-American out of the California ranks from Roland Heights, California, has now hit 2 in a row. First and 10 at the Minnesota 45. The pitch is back to Jacobs. Jacobs around the left side, turns the corner to the 50. Down to the Michigan 48-yard line. Again, it's Geergash. Jacobs giving Minnesota a little bit of punch now in the backfield. The Wolverines have been hurt defensively with the losses, but Minnesota been hurt with running backs. They lost Marvell Ross last week, Tony Hunter. The brilliant young freshman's been out, and Jacobs has been injured from the Indiana game, but now he is back and running well. There's Geergash, who's probably made at least four or five tackles already in this game. Second down and 5. Minnesota in Michigan territory for the first time today at the 49. Here's Hoynsey. Hoynsey, a quick spot pass is hit over here to Cooper. And Cooper makes his first catch down to the 40, and that'll be another first down in Minnesota. Tony Jackson has 3 interceptions this year, but he couldn't get that one. He did get the tackle, and it's first and 10 Gophers.
And again, Jim, good basic football. The cornerbacks are playing off. The quarterback just raised up and got the ball out to Cooper. You know, these are good plays. You know, if your running attack is not moving, get the ball out to the wide receivers, pick yourself up 4, 5, 6 yards. That time, first down.
Hoynsey's at 85 out of 174 coming in, almost 50%. And now he's clicking for the first time today with Michigan leading 3-0. Give it a fake, and here's Hoynsey rolling. Good fake. Fires downfield. Caught down here beautifully by Henry. The freshman fullback inside the 35 of Michigan. Mike Foran, an inside linebacker, makes a stop, number 40. Watch the play of Hoynsey.
And this is what you're going to have to do. He's going to have to roll out with the ball because he doesn't want to sit back in the pocket all day long because Michigan put a lot of pressure on him. That time he catches number 37, Manny Henry. Just an outstanding catch, one-handed catch.
Gain of 8 on the play, Terry, and it's second down and 8, or 2, and this is the best-looking offense that we've seen out of Minnesota by far.
Jim, it's the best field position they've had all day.
Down the Michigan 33, 32-yard line. Hoynsey pitches the ball back to Jacobs, trying to cut back, swarmed over and thrown for a loss. Tony Osmond led the charge from defensive left end, and that's the 9th time this year that Osmond has gotten through to throw a back for a loss. So he's kind of the counterpart of Carl Mecklenburg. Last time Minnesota won over Michigan is the last time Michigan was shut out. That was the 16-0 game when Michigan was ranked number 1 in the country, 1977. It was a big play, Terry, for Minnesota. 3rd and 5, no blitz. Hoynsey with time. Hoynsey fires down the right side. Dropped by Henry. Henry, the freshman, had a chance to catch that ball. Whether he made a first down or not, I don't know, because in hot pursuit that time was number 94, Jim Herman.
I mean, it's a good throw by Hennessy, right on the money. Last time he caught the ball one-handed. This time he's right in the bread basket and he missed it.
Paul Blanchard will be sent in the punt now. He'll try to put Michigan in a deep hole. They're not quite in the range of Jim Gallery, although Gallery has been on a great try. Gallery's going to try one. Well, he's going to try 52 yards.
I don't think he's going to kick it. I think it's going to be a little razzle-dazzle because he's going into a pretty good wind here, about 15 miles an hour.
He kicked a 57-yarder, but he is going just to win. Nope, he's going to give it a go. It's going to be way short down the end zone. That ball will be brought back out now the line of scrimmage, which is the 35-yard line, and Michigan's going to get pretty good field position out of that, and I don't know about that decision.
No, I think, you know, either a little razzle-dazzle on the kick or put your quarterback in there and let him throw the ball because Hohensee has been hitting his backs and getting those 5 yards.
Okay, Michigan gets the ball, leading by 3-0. One minute, 30 seconds to go in the first period. Michigan leads 3-0. Michigan takes over the ball again. Same backfield in there. Smith, Edwards, and Wolford for Michigan. Here's a play action fake. Smith going down the middle, and there's Carter. Takes it up to 45 in Minnesota territory. A beautiful down and out sideline pattern. Rick Willis was there, but he was hand-tied by the great pattern run by Carter.
And Minnesota is rolling up the defense on him. The safety, number 42, Andre Harris, is coming up for the short zone, but there's a dead spot is right in between him, and you can't find a better throw by Smith than that. And a very good pattern by Carter, because what he did, he went down, he put a move to the inside, sucked the safety, and then came back to the outside.
He's had catches now in 16 consecutive ball games. Anthony Carter, a surefire All-American for this year, without a doubt. First down play for Michigan. Play action again by Smith. To the left side. Carter's there. Takes it at the 30. Breaks the tackle. Down the sidelines. Out of bounds and around the 17-yard line by Glenn Cardelli.
Okay, that time Minnesota gambled because they figured that Michigan would not throw the ball two times in a row because they had one-on-one coverage out there. Glenn Cardelli. And there's no way in the world you can cover Anthony Carter with one man. You know, they had trouble to play before, Jim, covering with two.
Well, Michigan got the ball in pretty good field spot after the missed field goal at the 30-yard line. And in two big plays, they have rolled with Smith hitting Carter. And now they're at the Minnesota 17, first and 10. Carter, who's now caught three passes for 70 yards. And again, up the middle, Stan Edwards, the fullback. Bucks down around the 10. Rick Whithouse, the safety. Looked like the first man was there to hit him.
And when you start throwing that ball, it really opens up your running game. Because you get that defense a little leery out there, thinking pass. Now they're going to run big fullback Edwards up the middle.
And it's going to be second down and 2. A gain of 8 on the play by Edwards. Edwards has gone over the 2,000-yard mark for his career here today. He's taken over the number 10 spot, the all-time rusher. And before the season's over, he should pass the legendary Tom Hunter.
Not bad company.
Second down play. Here comes Smith. Look, he wants a touchdown. Goes to Simon Edwards for the score. Stan Edwards out of the backfield, wide open. Dick Whithouse was drawn in. Edwards got behind him. And Smith, who's on the money today, and that may spell a long afternoon for Minnesota as Michigan scores. The first touchdown is now 9-0.
What really happened here, Jim, is that they took Anthony Carter out of the ballgame, brought another tight end in. So Minnesota's thinking run. That time Smith rolls out, and you see the linebacker just blew the coverage, and Edwards just walks in with the ball.
Ali Hajisheik is in to try for the point. B.J. Dickey will hold at the 10. Michigan leads 9-0. They'll try to go up 10-0. There was a good look at Stan Edwards, who scored a touchdown, his first of the year. Here's the snap, and the kick is through. So it is 10-0 now. Michigan trying to get its sixth victory in 8 games, leading the University of Minnesota with 29 seconds to go in the first period. And that was a very quick order for Michigan downfield.
I thought it was just an awesome drive by Michigan. And what really happened is, you know, Smith is throwing the ball extremely well. Carter's running great pass pattern. He beat a double zone. He beat man-to-man coverage to give him 2 big gainers.
Ali Hajisheik remains on for the kickoff for Michigan, number 6. And back deep, freshman pair of Kerry Glenn and Manny Henry. Bo Schembechler from the sidelines for Michigan. There's number 37, Manny Henry, has averaged almost 26 yards a return, although Minnesota's had no chance today. Hodges Cheeks with both kickoffs beyond return, one past the end zone, the other to the back line.
I tell you, if Ali has a sore leg, I'd like to see him on a good day.
Well, he was a questionable starter here today because he had missed the Northwestern game with a pulled thigh muscle, and they weren't sure he'd be able to kick. They had Bob Bergeron standing by, so something magic for Hodges Cheeks. And here goes again. Well, sailing kick will be returnable this time, and he's taken by Henry. Manny Henry dropped it. Now he comes up over the 10 and to the 15, not much more. So Henry, a little bit of a bobble, put him more in a hole, and he's at the 15-yard line. Jerry Burgi stopped him for Michigan. And Minnesota will have maybe time for a play or so here in the final seconds of the first period. 10 to nothing, 23 seconds to go in the quarter. Michigan leads Minnesota. They're fighting for the little brown jug. It's been won 11 of the 12 years though Schembechler has coached Ann Arbor. Mike Cohen sees still a quarterback. Manny Henry and Frank Jacobs still in the backfield. We may see some Walter Ross or Tony Hunter before the day's over, but not yet. Still Henry Jacobs. Cohen sees giving it off to Henry. Throw back, cutting back to his right. Gets three or four tough yards before Mike Boyne chills him around the 20-yard line. That should end the first period. We have 12 seconds to go in this counting, and they'll probably not get out of the huddle here at Memorial Stadium for this one. Minnesota sidelines. Golden Gophers are excited about the start they've had this year, winning 5 out of 7, a big one last week at Iowa. And there's the end of the first quarter. And Minneapolis, on a beautiful day, it is Michigan 10 and Minnesota nothing. Well, we'd like to remind you about the Atlanta Journal 500 coming up here on ESPN of NASCAR's racing series. That'll be live on Sunday, November the 8th at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 9:30 Pacific Time. ESPN's live NASCAR race features the Winston Cup stars. Darrell Waldrop just having a spectacular year down there. He's overtaken Bobby Allison. Looks like he's going to win the point championship with Junior Johnson, Terry. And these guys, they ask no quarter.
Very few people consider them athletes. But what they do in those cars is just phenomenal. Oh, yeah. I have trouble driving on a freeway.
Say that again. Well, make sure that you make that, mark that date down. Sunday, November 8th, live at 12:30 Eastern Time, the Atlanta Journal 500 from Atlanta. All the stars of NASCAR. Okay. Seats are at a premium here, so they're looking for every spot available to watch this game today at the old Brick House. Memorial Stadium, and that crew is quite a long ways away, almost a block away. Right now, they're getting a glimpse of the action. If they move down the other end of the stadium, those folks will not be able to see. Bob Stroud now is in a tailback, replacing Jacobs. Henry remains. Nope, they're going to leave Jacobs in. There's a flare pass to Jacobs. Out of the 20, look for tackle, up to 25, maybe have a first down. Oh, dear guys, back there from Michigan. And watch this play to Jacobs.
Okay, you're going to see Giergaerth, but also number 9, Carpenter, is going to come up and try to make the open field tackle on Jacobs. Misses Giergaerth, a nice form tackle. That's what you like to see, those linebackers making those kind of tackles in the open field.
It is a first down for Minnesota. So Stroup has come in at fullback, and Jacobs now is running a tailback. They're in the split back setup for one of the rare times. First and 10, Minnesota. Hoynsey out of his backfield. He has hit Jacobs again. Short gain over the 30. Giergaerth one more time on the tackle. Boy, he's been all over the field today. This junior linebacker from Lakewood, Ohio. Leading tackler for Michigan for the season, and you can understand why just watching him here in the first half.
And this is exactly what Minnesota has to do in order to beat this Michigan defense. They got to try to nickel and dime him to death. Use the running play just as a nuisance play, you know, just to keep the defense honest. But Hoynsey is going to have a big day throwing the ball.
A quick glimpse there at Smokey Joe Salem, whose son is the backup quarterback here. Matter of fact, they've been the starter. Well, oh, Michigan might have been offsides. There's the pitch to Jacobs. Penalty markers are down all over. Jacobs met solidly at the 32 by Carlton Rose. But I think maybe that somebody jumped offside. Might have been Rose. Oh, he made the tackle. Could have been Lemeron at the other side, or Clay Miller at the end. Somebody was moving for Michigan. Offsides against Minnesota. Well, it was Minnesota that drew him off.
Well, no,
now they changed it. So it was Michigan. Joe Salem, who played here on the national championship team of 1960 that went to the Rose Bowl under Murray Warmoth, then coached out at South Dakota for 9 years, Northern Arizona for four more, had a great record there in the Division II, and now he's come back home to lead the Wolverines. And today he's up against one of the all-time great winning coaches in Big Ten history, Bo Schembechler, who played for Woody Hayes at Miami, Ohio, coached there for 9 years, but at Michigan, he has carved his niche, and only two active coaches have won more. And only Fielding Yost won more at Michigan.
Here's a waist down for Minnesota. Second down and less than a yard to go. And go for the bomb here, or just, or maybe just try to pick up the first down.
I'd
go
for it. ONC doesn't want to. He gets the first down and stops. Big fullback plunges with yards to spare as he goes to the 40-yard line. Ridden down there, Carlton Rose in the play for Michigan. And the bottom of the stack for the Wolverines looks like the number 40, Mike Bourne. Bourne, who was the ABC television player of the game in the against Notre Dame, had 80 tackles this year. He is second to Geergash, so those are two very active linebackers for Bo Schembechler. They spotted on the 39, first and 10, Minnesota.
Jim, they've been thrown from this formation before, a split back. Let's see what they do here.
Well, they've got Cooper on the short side here to the right. Only one running back is Stout. They put Henry over the slot, and here comes the new motion. Now they shift a little more. They got to hurry. Points. Once the throw. There's a blitz. They got a man down by Cooper. Cooper, first down near 50. Brian Carpenter on the hip, but Cooper went down and hooked in open. And that was a beautiful route by Chester Cooper, leading receiver from Minnesota.
And a good philosophy. Carpenter's playing off about 10 to 12 yards. Take that little short, 10-yard route there, because he's got to give Cooper a lot of respect. He's got to back off. Got him in man-to-man coverage, short side of the field. He got there all day long.
Cooper holds the all-time record of Minnesota. He's now over 600 yards in receiving this year. Closing in on the all-time reception mark set by Ron Kellis in 1975. Here's another throwaway down. Oh, they make a foul blitz, a pickup, and Hoinsky gets the first down. That's how to turn a busted snap into an advantage.
Shows good savvy by Hoinsky. You realize he made the mistake, dropped the football, or something between the center and quarterback at that point.
That'll be first down Minnesota. They're back in Michigan territory for the second time today. At the 49-yard line, Jay Carroll, number 83, brought the play in there for Joe Salem. Here's Hoinsky, who actually beat out Tim Salem back in the preseason for the quarterback spot. And he's been outstanding. Hoinsky pitches it back here to Jacobs. Jacobs looking for the opening that doesn't happen. Mike Bourne came underneath and closed the gap. So Bourne really closed it down, and here's a look at it.
Look at Delafleur here. I mean, just outstanding. But if you're going to run to the outside, you got to get that form. You got to get to the outside, then just twist him in. And that time, just outstanding. That's where that form tackling him. They're going to run that play back 5-10 times in the film session. Bet on that one.
At the Michigan 48, a gain of a yard. It'll be second down and 9 for Mike Hoinsky and the Minnesota Gophers. They trail 10-0 here with white-clad Michigan in the lead. Back there quickly. Good protection. Hoinsky.
Watch out.
Broken up. Oh, great coverage over there by Ken Bostic. That was intended for Jake Carroll, the tight end. And Bostic was right on him. Could have intercepted the ball.
Okay, now here's the signal. The two backup quarterbacks, second and third team, are going to flash the plays into Hoinsky. See, each of them giving a different signal. Look at that. Oh, my God. You've got to be in good shape just to do that.
It'll be third down and 8 at the, or third down and 9 at the 48-yard line. We got the 1 yard gain on first down, incomplete pass. Now Hoinsky, passing situation. He wants the eye in the backfield with Jacobs in the tailback. Stroud is the fullback. Rolling out. That's what he wanted, the protection away from the blitz. There's the fire, incomplete and interference. That'll be on Carpenter, who had his hands all over the receiver. Another break here for Minnesota, but Carpenter obviously had contact with Chester Cooper before the ball arrived. It'll be a first down for Minnesota around the Michigan 35-yard line.
Hey, Cooper's been doing that route all day long. That's time number 9, Carpenter said he's not going to do it this time. Try to get a little closer coverage on him and come up with the interference.
Good, strong safety blitz that time, a safety blitz by Keith Bostic. And I think Owens had called the right play, Terry, because he had him rolling out. That got him away from the blitz a little bit.
Yeah, if you get that pressure up the middle, whether it's a good pass rush or a blitz, you got to get to the outside because there's no way to pick that up because there's no one to pick up that safety. He's just uncovered.
Nick Davidson now is coming over Chester Cooper. Weckbacker and Davidson are the wide receivers. They've got... Now again, you see Hornsey moving his best setbacks around. Hornsey straight back this time. Hornsey fires the sidelines, and it is caught. No, it did drop. Incomplete. No argument there by Jacobs, but the official was right on the play. So he must have trapped it.
Again, trying to isolate the running back on the linebacker. You know, good philosophy. Let's see what Jacobs does here. It's the ball here, pulls it in, drops to the ground, picks it up real quick, but not quick enough. Guys in the stripes made the right call.
That's a beautiful call. He's right on top of the play. Good job here by Richard McVay and his team. Second and 10. Hornsey, very strong arm passer from Minnesota. He has the goal for moving. Hornsey fires it. Man,
nice throw.
And it's caught near the 21-yard line by Weckbacker. Ron Weckbacker, number 19, hauls it in over Brian Carpenter's coverage. And it's first and 10, Minnesota at the Michigan 23-yard line.
Okay, you've got to give a lot of credit to that offensive line. Look at that pocket. Hohensee stays in there strong. Weckbacker drove his man off, came down, and what he did there to make that play successful is he came back towards the quarterback. He didn't allow a defensive man to step in between him and the quarterback. Nice pattern by Weckbacker.
All right, Davidson replaces Weckbacker now. It's Davidson and Cooper, the wide receivers. Tailback here is Jacobs in the eye. Hoynes is the man of the hour, though, and he fakes in the play action rolling. Hoynes is being rushed, fires the end zone. There is Cooper. It's incomplete. Intended for Cooper, and Carpenter was covering. Well, Hoynes, he wanted all of it there, but that was just super coverage by number 9, Brian Carpenter, who's coming off a sprained ankle and starting today. Carpenter didn't get his starting call until this morning. That decision was made by Bo Schembechler's staff, and he's had quite a day. But so is Mike Hoynes so far, 8 out of 16, 66 yards.
So far, Minnesota's done an outstanding job protecting Hoynes. I think he's only had pressure maybe one or two times. I'll tell you, this play was not a bust, because what this tells Michigan is that, hey, we are going to go deep sometimes. It better stay loose back there.
Cooper at the top of your screen, spin to the left, out the right, Ron Weckbacker. Hoynsey, no doubt, will be going to the air. Second down, play rolling. Hoynsey, got time. Hoynsey fires up the middle, incomplete.
Oh!
That interference called again. Jay Carroll, tight end, hit by Evan Cooper. And that's quite a tough break for Michigan, because Hoynes, who was way off the mark with that call, that pass. Cooper called for holding, and it'll be first and goal, I believe, for Minnesota.
And I'll tell you, Jim, I think a very great call, because, you know, Hoynes was way off the mark there, and if there was any contact, it was just a mere brush. And Cooper, I mean, he could be the goat on this play, but I'll tell you, you really can't get down on the kid for that play, because it was, you know, I consider a bad call by the officials.
Penalty is down to the 5. It is first and goal, Minnesota, the Michigan 5, and Michigan's defense has not allowed a touchdown in 10 quarters. Now being threatened by Minnesota with 10 and a half minutes to go in the first half. Well, Bo Schembechler, a little peeved over that one, but here's Minnesota with a golden opportunity to score. And they give it to Jacobs. Coming to the outside, cuts back, goes to the 3. Mike Thorne starting Frank Jacobs. The 240s meet at the Michigan 3, but a pickup of 2 yards, and that's all Minnesota needs here. It'll be second and goal at the 3-yard line.
I look for Michigan to use Hoynsey, get him outside of containment, give him the run-pass option here. You got a lot of field to the left-hand side. Let him get out there, because he has the speed and he can run the football.
That was the 5th penalty on Michigan for 63 yards. Now this proud Michigan defense being threatened to be scored on for the first time since October the 10th. And now they give it again to Jacobs, and he is cracked hard at the line of scrimmage. Jacobs got little, if anything, on that play. The first hit by Keith Bostic, and then Paul Giergash. Strong safety and a linebacker, and now we think we'll see Hoynsey perhaps go to the air.
Well, he has to here. I would have done it on a second down, because, you know, you have to use a little element of surprise here.
There's the Michigan defense. You know, last year they didn't give up a touchdown the last 5 and a half games. They haven't allowed one down in 2 and a half games. Here's the third down, goal to go. Here comes Carroll in motion. Hornsey, play action. Hornsey looks. Hornsey. Hornsey's got room to run. Hornsey scores. Touchdown for Minnesota. Streak is over for the Michigan defense. Mike Hornsey, back to pass, everybody covered. And what an outstanding young man this is from Roland Heights, California. He has played well here in the second half. He's brought Minnesota back now within 4 points. It is 10-6. And on to try for the point after is Jim Galloway. Galloway didn't miss last year, and he's on a hot streak again. Weckbacker will hold at the 10. And Galloway busted it through there. The seventh point for Minnesota. The lead now is back to the 3-point field goal kicked by Hajishik. And so Minnesota is on the boards, and we've got a different looking game now with 9:15 to go in the half, 10-7. Another look at the touchdown play, Terry Hedren.
And Jim, when you're down in goal line defense, the only man that is uncovered by the defense is the quarterback. So you got to roll him out. He has the ability to run the ball. If the defense drops back to cover the pass, do exactly what Mike Hornsey did right there.
Well, that's great effort, wasn't it, on the end of that run? He just split two defenders of Michigan to score the first time in 10, 11 quarters now that the Michigan defense has given up a touchdown. Not since October 10th had the Michigan defense had been scored on. That was against Michigan State. But Minnesota's done it here. Anthony Carter is back deep. Yes,
Terry. Even more important than that, Minnesota has not scored a touchdown in an awful long time.
That's right. It breaks a long string. They've gone 8 quarters without scoring a touchdown of their own. So two streaks have ended. Anthony Carter, Stan Edwards deep. There's Edwards, number 32. Carter, of course, number one. Kicking off Jim Galloway from Minnesota. Booming kick, very high. Even in zone, and he's down there by Edwards. And Michigan now will start from the 20-yard line, first and 10. And we have not a brand new game, but it's certainly 10-7. A different complexion now as Minnesota has gotten back in the competition here with 9 minutes and 15 seconds to go in the first half. Capacity crowd here of over 50,000 at Memorial Stadium for today's game. And what a finish we're going to have in the Big Ten this year, and it's not going to be decided for another few weeks. Michigan won it last year, won the Rose Bowl over Washington, and they'd like to repeat. They have those two big losses. Wolfrick at the tailback of the pitch. Here comes Anthony, and up, and a fake. Flags were going everywhere, and now it's a tough break for Michigan. That's the first time today they called the end around, but it was stopped on the illegal procedure.
And the bad part about that, Jim, is you can only run that play out maybe twice a game at the most. And to use it and have a penalty before he can even get it started, because I'll tell you what, they had a heck of a wall out there set for Anthony Carter. And with his ability, no telling what he can do with the ball.
Well, Anthony, who has 27 career touchdowns, is always a threat. He scored every 7 times he's touched the ball, and it's a career Michigan. There's the penalty situation. That's the 6th against Michigan. Well, Michigan kind of hurting itself a little bit, especially on that play. Penalized back to the 15. Bo Schembechler really growling along the sidelines now. Carter has been replaced by Bean. Brent Harms is now the defense for Minnesota, a right tackle replacing Mecklenburg. Here's the option rollout run by Smith. Smith's going to run it. Smith along the sidelines gets back close to the 20, and then he's pounded over the sidelines there.
Say, Jim, that was called a quarterback sweep because there was no receiver downfield. They were just out there. Smith made a little fake like he was going to throw the ball, but there wasn't anybody down there. That was run all the way.
Got back to the 20, so they picked up the yards lost in the penalty, and it's 2nd and 10. Here comes Carter now back on the field. We'll see now if that reverse is called again today. They love to bring Carter from his wide spot. Now they put Carter out to the wide side of the field, which indicates he probably won't come here. They love to have Carter to the boundary. Now here they're looking for Carter. Here's the square out pass. Carter takes it and put down immediately short of the first down. Then Cardelli makes a stop, but it's going to be 3rd down and 1 at the 29-yard line. Carter a little down and out. Almost had to give him that play because it was deep for a great speed.
And what you're going to see You're going to see Carter run this out continually, pick up the 8 to 10 yards. Then you're going to see the cornerbacks, Cardelli, and all of a sudden he's going to bite on, and that's the time Carter's going to go down the field on.
Carter goes to top of the screen. Michigan only looking for a yard here now with Butch Wolfolk and the tailback and Stan Redbergs. That fullback gives them a great 1-2 punch. They give it to Edwards, and he is hit at the 30. It's going to be close. Jim Fonhorst, an inside linebacker from Minnesota. It just depends on where they spot the ball. They put it on the 30. It's going to be first down for Michigan. Wolf just barely made it at the 30-yard line. Remember, they started on the touchback of the 20. That's been an interesting ball game. Michigan in the first period, and Minnesota's come back in the second quarter. Anthony Carter out to the right. The left is Vince Bean. The tailback is Wolfham. Boy, Michigan really has the guns in its arsenal for this season. They give it to Wolfham. Wolfham to the left side, gets away. And now he's taken down hard at the 30-yard line. Rick Widhouse, the safety man, got him. After Wolfolk was hit first, the line of scrimmage looked like he'd be stopped for no gain, but then he made his own play.
And we mentioned about Michigan's outstanding offensive line. And, you know, this one really does it for Wolfolk. You know, Betts, the tight end, you see him right there, number 82, outstanding block on the linebacker. And this really loosens them up, especially when you put Carter to the wide side of the field. Then you run Wolfolk back to the short side of the field. You know which way these guys are going to go. See, I'd double cover Carter even in the locker room.
Well, Carter's out the top of your screen to your left. And here's Smith back and looking. Fresh on down the middle. It goes to Bean. Incomplete. Bean on a deep post. Glenn Cardelli was staying with him. The ball's overthrown. Incomplete. So it'll be third and five at the 35-yard line. Clock shows 7 minutes, 15 seconds to go in the half. And it's 10-7. Michigan leads by 3. Field goal opened the scoring by Haji Sheik. Another touchdown by Michigan. And Minnesota came back to end Michigan's long scoreless streak. Score its own. Hoynesy on a keep. Mecklenburg back in the defense for Minnesota. Smith got time. Smith fires and it is incomplete. Intended for Bean. Bean covered deep. Lost his footing, but the pass is thrown wide and out of bounds.
Tell you, don't really fault Smith on this one. This is really an outstanding pass. Number 27, Bean, falls down. And this is a timing pass. The ball has to be put in the air. And that's not the initial fall. He had a slip before that.
I'll tell you,
that's the second effort for the ball right there.
Greg Nettles would have had that one, Derek.
I believe he would have, on the hot corner.
That's right. Here's Don Bracken to punt. Cardelli and Schlichting are waiting for Minnesota. Bracken has an outstanding punting year going for Michigan. Over 45 yards a kick, and this is not a good one. Comes down short, and it's getting a great Michigan bounce, though. Inside the 25, inside the 20, and down on the 19. Boy, Michigan fortunate there as Bracken kicked it short, but it bounced deep. It'll be Minnesota's ball now. The score, Michigan leads 10-7. Minnesota 81 yards away from getting toward the lead, or maybe trying to get back to give Jim Gallery a chance to tie here with a lot of time, almost 7 minutes left in the first half. Hoynesy's been a standout for Minnesota. And their quarterback gives to his fullback, Henry. Slam to the left side, penalty flag thrown. Henry is hit by Clay Miller. And now let's see if we've got a face mask or holding. Was tossed right into the stack, and it looks like it's going to be against Minnesota. Gophers are sensing that penalty is going to be upcoming against them, and now watch the signal here from Richard McVay. It is holding against Minnesota. That'll cost the Gophers. That kind of tips the scales a little bit more back toward evening things up here in penalties that have gone heavily against Michigan in the first half. There's the Gopher. Golden Gophers is a name that goes way back in Minnesota history. Matter of fact, goes back in the 1800s, way before this school even had a football team. Came out of some political shenanigans that saw Minnesota named as the Gopher State. And then they became Golden Gophers here several years ago under the great Bernie Bierman. Back at the 11, it is first and 20, first and 18. Draw a play.
All right.
That one, Henry the 20. 25-yard line. This is a great football. Over the 30 for first down. Wick backer, a great block, and he sprung Henry loose. Carlton Rose put him out of bounds, but not before a first down. A brilliant call and a great execution by Minnesota.
I'll tell you what, when you're a passing team, you have to have the draw in your arsenal, because that defense, as you saw, everybody's backing up into their deep zones. And that time, Henry, number 37, put some good moves on himself, got some good blocks from his friend downfield. Just an outstanding call by Minnesota.
Only a freshman from Evanston, Illinois, Manny Henry, and the best run of the ball game for the Golden Gophers. Now let's see if Hoynsey goes to work with better field position. Play action rolling. Hoynsey being chased. Hoynsey's got some speed of his own. Fires on the go. Caught on a tight end peril at the 50-yard line. It's another first down for Minnesota. Lamoron was putting pressure on Hoynsey that time, but on the run, he got the pass off to Carroll, and he completes it for another first down.
I'll tell you, give Mike Hoynsey all the credit in the world, Matt, because he just completed probably the toughest pass a quarterback can do, rolling out to his right and having to throw the ball across his body into the middle of the field and hit Carroll.
Frank Jacobs now comes on, and I think Michigan wants a timeout. Minnesota wants a timeout. They stop the clock. Still 6 minutes, 15 seconds to go in the first half. Walter Ross is coming in the field for the first time for Frank Jacobs for Minnesota. And here are the Golden Gophers back in Michigan, or rather, the ball is right at the 50, maybe nose of the Michigan territory. There's the story. Michigan 10, Minnesota 7. The winner of this game is still going to be very much in the thick of the Big Ten race. Now Jacobs is going to go out. He's the leading rusher from Minnesota. He had a deep thigh bruise, which he suffered against Indiana. Could have been re-damaged here in this game. Leading scorer and leading rusher for Minnesota. Played pretty well here in the first half. Now he's been replaced by Walter Ross, who's a speedster, 9'7" sprint star, junior from St. Petersburg, Florida. There's Chester Cooper, number 43. He's coming wide right. Let's see what Hoynsey does on first down. Play action. Hoynsey pumps. Hoynsey fires down the left side. It is broken up and intercepted by Michigan. Keith Bostic, a strong safety, intercepts, first intercepts of the game, intended for Weckbacker. And that time, Hoynsey lost his magic, and Bostic, from double coverage, was there. Looked like he threw into a crowd, Terry.
Jim, I mentioned earlier, Hoynsey's been threatening a little bit down here, throwing the ball into the double coverage, and that time they had Weckbacker. He was just, you know, double covered. We'll see it here coming up. See, there's going to be a man in front and a man in back. And that's, my friends, you don't throw the ball there. Number 13, Keith Bostic, comes up with a good interception, keeps his feet in bounds like a receiver.
And now it's Michigan's ball at the Michigan 25-yard line. They stopped the drive that had gone about 30 yards from Minnesota. And here's Steve Smith with his crew. Backsmith getting off to Edwards, coming outside. Edwards breaks a couple of tackles, and then he goes down under a swarm, and there goes a penalty flag down. Then Seslevich, the first man to hit Smith, and then a late flag thrown, and maybe against Michigan. Could be clipping here, which was up beyond the play. And that'll be another tough break for the Wolverines, because that play had been, it was over for all intents and purposes. Watch the referee, Richard McVay. Personal foul, Michigan.
Oh, this third ball.
Yeah, might have been a late pile-on by the offensive team, which is kind of unusual. And, all right, well, you know how Bo feels about it. He just put his vote in as being the other way. We'll leave it at that. I tell you, when Bo played, he probably saw his coach go out on the field a time or two, wouldn't you think?
Woody Hayes did that occasionally.
Occasionally. Back at the 14, but two great coaches they were, coming out of the cradle of coaches, Miami of Ohio, that's produced the likes of Paul Brown, Red Blake, Paul Dietzel, Era Parsegian, and the list goes on and on. Dick Crum now doing a great job in North Carolina, came from Miami. Carmen Kaza and so many, many more, including Bo Schembechler. And here's his Michigan team back in a hole now. Second and 20. Throw back, fake, deep by Smith. Smith the quarterback. Going to get very little. Jim Feinhorst did a super job in pursuit. So did Jimmy James. And they stopped Steve Smith with only minimal damage as he advances it out maybe to the 18-yard line.
Jim, Minnesota at that time had a perfect defense. There's Butch Wolf for the day, 5 yards for 12 carries. I'll tell you what, he's a lot better back than that, and he's got to be a big factor in this ball game if Michigan's going to get out of the hole.
Well, I think Minnesota's really been keying on Butch today, Terry.
Well, you have to. You really have to. I mean, he's an outstanding running back, and they're going to have to use number one out there a little more, Anthony Carter.
Well, they've got Lawrence Ricks, who's a great back in his own right, in replacing Wolf. So Ricks is now the tailback.
Don't sell Rick short.
There's a fake, and now here's Smith. Good time. Over the
got
middle.
Him.
And he has got his man. It is caught. Woodhouse making the stop. That, well, will be close to first down, but may just miss again. Another stop. Vince Bean was the receiver, by the way. Watch this beautiful delivery by Smith.
And they rolled the whole defense to Carter that time. Not a pretty pass, but it got out right on the money to Bean. And you're going to have to do this. You know, take the pressure off Carter a little bit. Take the pressure off Wolfo. Get Bean involved because he's an outstanding receiver. And catch the ball over the middle, he can go deep.
It was the first down. Now Wolfo comes back in the game. Wolfo in. Lawrence Ricks out. So Wolfo again is a tailback with Edwards at full. Here's Smith, number 16. Anthony Carter is up the top of the screen to the right. They out of the draw play to Wolfo. And again, that's what he's waiting for. Boy, Wolfo has been a shattered man today. Kevin Kellen, the left tackle, the first man to break through, 258 pounds, 6 foot six from Grand Rapids, Minnesota. Loss is back to the 32. A loss of five. So Wolfolk is down to what? About 7 yards net now on the day. Oh, that's really unusual for Butch. 138 yards a game he is averaging this year. Second and long yardage again for Smith. Take the fullback. Here comes the option. Smith has room. Smith turns the corner. Breaks the tackle. To
watch
the
out!
35 from behind at the 30-yard line. Rick Woodhouse stopped the touchdown play by Smith, who almost broke in the distance. And as he turned the corner, he really had running room.
I'll tell you, I mentioned before, Smith has a 4-5 speed in the 40. This time, a good quarterback, he's got to realize that they had the man out there on Wolfolk. Now turn up field. Now you've got to realize here, you're going to have a little contact downfield, so hang on to that football. And just an outstanding move right here to the inside. You see the defender come and knock the ball away. Luckily, it went out of bounds for Michigan.
Well, they said that he was stepped out of bounds at the 36-yard line. That's going to be Michigan's ball. Clock shows 3:10 to go in the first half. Minnesota, Michigan getting down at least close to field goal range. Here's a quick one out in the flat to Anthony Carter. Carter, the 30, turns on his speed. The outside gets out of bounds around the 25-yard line. Andre Harris was there to make sure Carter didn't break it. Joe Salem now watching his defense being challenged here by Michigan again. A little over 3 minutes to go in the half.
And I'll tell you, if I was a quarterback out there, I'd audible every time I saw Anthony Carter with one-on-one coverage, I'd audible to that play. Because he's going to get you 8-10 yards. He could break it to the outside. I think they're going to call a little late hit there.
Yep, that was out of bounds.
Number.
You got a good look at it on the replay. Carter was hit after he crossed the boundary, and that's going to go against Minnesota. So Michigan will be a first down, and it'll be half the distance, but around the 12-yard line. And Michigan now with an opportunity to score again here in the final minutes of the first half. They lead 10, so well, they put it down on the 14. Now the referee's going to change that. I thought they would go to the 12 because he's marked out of bounds on the 12, the 24. So the ball's down to about the 12-yard line. It's first and 10 there for Michigan. A little gloom gathering there on the Minnesota sidelines here as Michigan now has come roaring out of a hole, led by Steve Smith. He broke the long run from quarterback. He's accounted for 14 touchdowns this year, 7 passing, 7 running. Carter's down the left side. They got single coverage again here on Carter. Let's see what happened. Nope, now they're setting up double coverage. Here's the pitch out to Wolfen. Wolfen trying to cut back that room. Inside the 10 and dives down to the 5. Butch Wolfen, his best run with a super tackle there by Glenn Seslevich that might have saved the touchdown. And when Wolfen changes gears, he can really go. Watch Seslevich, 34, Terry.
It really helps as they have double coverage on Anthony Carter, which takes a man away from pursuit. Now watch number 26 come in, Mike Rupp. goodbye to him. Wolfolk just puts a great move. If you can get him outside with no containment, watch out. He's going to get you some yards.
All right, it's second and two for Michigan. 4 yards to go for another touchdown, about four and a half, and motion goes Dunaway. And here is the give up the middle to Edwards. Fullback tries to find some running room. It's really tough to get it down here at the middle. Minnesota closes it down around the three, and it may be a first down. Let's see.
A great position to be. Second and goal from the five, and you're still... I mean, second and two, I should say. Second and three for a first down.
Jimmy James on the stop. Our referee, Richard McVay, wants the change brought into measure. Clock shows 2:12 remaining in the first half. So Michigan stands at all probability of scoring something here, and at the moment, looks like they have a great opportunity to get at least to get a touchdown. Lead is 10-7. Just that much. Just that much. So it'll be third and inches. So now what's your call, Mr. Quarterback?
I give it to Edwards and let him run right over Becker's back.
Becker and Moransky, right?
Becker's just there. You see, he's the captain of the football team, All-American, and just an outstanding guard.
Good candidate for the Outland Trophy, wouldn't you say, number 65?
I would. I think he's, you know, he's going to be a great college player. I think he's going to be a great pro.
Well, here comes Smith in for word. I wouldn't be surprised. Bo leans a lot toward his guards, and he thinks maybe Becker could be the best he's ever had. Becker to the right side, the 65-72 of Moransky. That's going to be Smith on a keep, and Smith is caught and thrown down to two, but I think it's going to be a first down. Mike Pepe on a shoestring tackle. And Smith tried to fool the Minnesota defense, faking up the middle and then trying to skirt outside. Pepe played his position well. But it looks like it'll be a first down. He's down to the 2-yard line. And if so, it'll be first and goal, Michigan, with 1:46 to go. Time could become an element if Michigan sticks to the ground. Say they don't get the score in the first two or three plays, then time could be running on. Of course, the Wolverines have got three timeouts remaining. First down, no measurement needed. It's first down, Michigan. They got 2 yards to go for a touchdown.
I don't think Bo's going to get fancy twice in a row.
Going to go to Edwards, right?
We've got four shots here to give it, put it in.
Edwards and Wolfolk. Well, that's a great 1-2 punch running. Bo runs it in. Well, it goes back to his days under Woody Hayes, and I would lean toward the conservative style of play, and it's paid off well for Michigan over the years. Bo probably mixing a little more razzle-dazzle, especially with guys like Carter. Wolfolk and Edwards right behind Smith. Smith looking end zone, touchdown. Caught in there by Edwards, the fullback. Okay, let's see who it is. It's Edwards, Stan Edwards, the fullback. Gets the touchdown, the second one today. And nobody touched it.
Everybody in the stadium, including this booth here, thought it was going to be a run. And that time, Edward just snuck on the flat, and everybody, the linebackers, the safeties, were all up there to try to stop the run. And Bo did do a little razzle-dazzle twice in a row.
All right, 16-7 now, Michigan leading. Haji Sheik is in to try for the point after. Holding will be B.J. Dickey. Dickey's a quarterback. If he ever wanted to try for 2 points, they got the tools there, but they don't expect it here. Going for the 10-point lead, Michigan. Snap, the kick is up, and it's good. And so Michigan has increased its lead back to 10 points, answering Minnesota's score here in the second period. The score now, Michigan 17, Minnesota 7. Back now for the kickoff from Michigan. Wolverines into a 10-point lead for the second time today. They led 10-0, and now it is 17-10. Kerry Glenn, Manny Henry waiting. There's number 37, Henry. Kerry Glenn, number 8, back there with him also. Haji Sheik, who the other kickoffs he's had put the ball out of play in the end zone. Then he kicked one that was returned by Henry, and now he must kick into the wind for the first time. 10 plays, 74 yards, 3 minutes and 38 seconds. That was the scoring drive for Michigan. The Wolverines still have plenty of offensive punch, and they responded well after giving up their first touchdown in 10 quarters to Minnesota. Part of their the crowd. There's a look at the scoring drive we told you. 3 minutes and 38 seconds, 74. The big run was Smith on the quarterback keep that put them down deep. And then Smith threw for the touchdown. It's his eighth touchdown pass of the year. Hodges' kickoff will be returned. It is Henry at the 2. Or the 10. 15. He runs right into the arms of a Michigan tackler. And he is taken down. That was number 44, I believe, John Lott, who made the stop for Michigan. And Haji Sheik kickoff is returned for the second time. Carlton Rose was there to make the hit along with John Lott. And so it is Minnesota at its own 16. First and 10. The clock shows 1:13 to go. And we can look for Mr. Hoensey, you think, Terry, to get the air.
He's going to put that ball up. Let's see, we've got 1 minute and 13 seconds to go. With a split back, though, that's your normal passing.
They guys going to run the draw. And it is the freshman again. This time, by just a last dive, was able to get anything out of the play. Mike Limeron diagnosed the play for Michigan, made the hit with Tony Osmond. No huddle here from Minnesota. Time running out. We're inside the minute now with 52 seconds to go in the half. Michigan leads by 10. Hoensey with protect. Hoensey fires down the right side. There's the man there. Incomplete. That was intended for Manny Henry, the fullback. Incomplete pass. That'll be third down. But good protection for Hoensey again, Terry.
He does an outstanding job of, you know, staying in the pocket. And it really helps the offensive line because they know where he's going to be. Had a little pressure there, but, you know, he really blacks out that pressure. And there you see the signals being waved from the sideline.
Number 6, by the way, is Todd Stout. And number 10 is Tim Salem, who's the son of head coach Joe Salem and was the starting quarterback here last year. There they are. Third down at 6. Minnesota's got to do something here up the middle, and they do. First down is hit to Jacobs. Jacobs on the 28-yard line, hit by Marion Boddy. That'll be a first down, Minnesota.
I'll tell you, Jim, that was an awful big first down, because if they miss there, Michigan gets the ball in pretty good field position again.
35 seconds to go in the first half. Minnesota has time, but they must hurry. They'd like to get it down at least in range for Jim Gallery, and here Gallery will have the advantage of the win. Gallery, who had kicked 8 of his last 10 field goals before he missed one in the first quarter against the wind, a 52-yard attempt. But now the wind will be the other way for Minnesota. There's the Michigan team. Defensive huddle here around the coordinator, Bill McCartney. It's been a patched-up Michigan defensive team. They had 5 starters out today. Winford Carraway, who's a nose guard with an ankle injury. Defensive tackle Cedric Coles out with an ankle. 2 linebackers, Robert Thompson, who's had surgery on his hand, and Ben Needham, who has a knee injury, all missing action. And Brian Carpenter just returned today. And Jeff Shaw, who may have been a starter at the nose guard spot, is out for disciplinary reasons. So Michigan's great defensive unit of last year returned almost intact, but it has been riddled by injury and other reasons. Hoensey, 10 out of 20, 95 yards. Pretty good stats, Terry.
It really is. I think, you know, he hasn't hit the big one yet, but he has 1 interception. He hasn't hit the big one, but he's been consistent in the short passes and moving the ball.
Got Weckbacker to the right and Cooper to the left. Cooper has not really been damaging so far. Here's Hoensey over the middle. He's hit his man. That's a throw by a tailback Jacobs, but he stays in bounds. The clock continues to roll. 25 seconds to go. Jacobs has been quite an asset in his return to the lineup for Minnesota. Geergas was the man on the tackle. They go without a huddle with 15 seconds to go and a half. Minnesota's got a strike in a hurry. They run the quick open up the middle of the fullback, Henry. Henry trying to get out of the down, stop at the 45. That'll stop the clock with 7 seconds to go. Marion Boddy made the stop. They're not yet in field goal range. Minnesota calling timeout here, so they have to go down the sidelines, don't they, Terry, just to get a pickup 10 yards or so and try for the long field goal?
I think that was a gutsy call on their part, because, you know, with the busting of the quarter ends. You see Michigan huddling on the sideline here with their defense.
And the other side, the Minnesota offense. Joe Salem. That 3 younger sons, an interesting story about one of his young sons became, at the Rose Bowl last year, became very close friends with Shimmy Schembechler, the son of Michigan's head coach, and the friendship grew to such a point that Shimmy is visiting the Salem family this week in Minnesota, and he's staying there, so maybe he picked up a couple plays. You suppose he would do that?
Well, pending on the outcome of this game, it could be a little testy.
The friendship is on the line. I don't think so. No, those two families are very close, except for today. Ball is at the Minnesota 45, but important factor here, only 7 seconds to go. Michigan wins. They take not only the Rose, the Little Brown Jug back to Ann Arbor, but they also take Shimmy back with them. Could be the last play of the half here. Minnesota hoping to get off something quick and then have time maybe to try the field goal, or he may just go for the bomb.
I think he's just going to go deep to Cooper.
Yeah, that's it. Here he goes, over the middle, and it is incomplete. Did it for Cooper with 1 second to go. Evan Cooper, challenging. Had he caught it, the half would be over anyway. So, no question what he has to do. There's the big 1 second, the top row there. The seven is the point score of Minnesota. They trail 17-7 to Michigan. 1 second ago, this barring penalty will be the last play of the half. And Michigan knows there's one play coming up and one only, and that is the long pass. You either try to complete for the touchdown or you get interference call against a defense. Has to be the two options for Minnesota. Michigan rushing only 3 men. Hoynesy with a good protection, stays right in the pocket. Here's Hoynesy, got a great strong arm. Hoynesy fires and is intercepted in the end zone, and they're going to run it out. Here comes Jackson out over the score, interception today. This half is still alive, and Jackson goes down the 26-yard line. Fourth interception of the year for Tony Jackson, and Bo Schembechler will take his Wolverines to the end to the locker room at halftime with a 10-point lead. It's Michigan 17 and Minnesota 7. Well, the story has this game, Michigan coming back to score again after Minnesota had cut the lead to 3. And the Wolverines lead it by 10 at halftime, 17-7 on the passing here of quarterback Steve Smith, who twice has hit his fullback Stan Edwards for touchdowns. His ninth touchdown pass of the year, his eighth and ninth. Statistically, here's how the two teams compare in the Little Brown Jug battle in Minnesota. First downs are dead even. Passing yardage are fairly well. They're pretty even all the way around the little edge of Michigan.
And I think a big factor, you know, you look at turnovers, but actually there was just one bad throw by Hoynesy. The last one was, you know, a hope shot right at the end of the first half, and you really can't count that as an interception. But as you said, you know, it is mentioned, are very close, and Michigan, and, you know, in the rushing yardage, a little advantage, and Minnesota is a little bit behind in the passing also. But, you know, the score, 17-7, but, you know, I think we're going to see an awful lot of football here in the second half.
Close game and could go either way. Would you say that, Terry?
I think so, Jimmy. I think Joe Salem's in the locker room going over a few things, and I think, you know, they just have to get Hoynesy, and they got to get the ball to Cooper.
All right, we'll be back for the second half kickoff in just a moment. Here it is, halftime with Michigan leading by 10. Wolverines 17, the Gophers of Minnesota 7. The Michigan Wolverines leading Minnesota by 17-7. Remember, Minnesota won the opening toss, so they receive. Michigan gets the second half option. The Wolverines will take the ball, and Minnesota comes out to kickoff to start the second half. What do you think about the second half? What do you look for, Terry?
Well, I think Coach Bo Schembechler went into the locker room and said, hey, guys, you know, awful lot of penalties in the first half. You know, we saw, you know, one great call, the pass interference on about the 4-yard line. But other than that, you know, they just had too many penalties, and they gave Minnesota quite a few breaks. But I think Minnesota's going to have to do basically what they did in the first half, Jim. And, you know, Hoynesy's got to throw the ball. He's got to roll out. He's got to get Cooper more involved in his offense.
Well, Schembechler with 9 Big Ten championships, but he's never had a losing year in his 18 years of coaching. Now in his 19th, this will be his 160th victory. And Joe Salem, in his 16th year, is closing in on the 100 victory mark.
Working on that bubble gum.
Right. He had 92 victories so far, 14 of them here at the University of Minnesota since taking over from at his alma mater. So Minnesota will kick off. Anthony Carter, Stan Edwards are deep for Michigan. Kicking off will be Jim Gallery for University of Minnesota. These kickers have been putting the ball back deep in the end zone. Now the wind at his back. Here comes Galvin. And he booms this one deep. Very deep. Way beyond. Through the uprights. That'll bring it out to the 20. And so Michigan will start there, first and 10 on the touchback. Gowney looks like he's limping a little bit as he goes off the side, but he really cracked that kickoff. Starting backfield will be the same alignment we began the game with Michigan and played most of the first half. Steve Smith, a quarterback group with two touchdowns. The man who caught him, Stan Edwards, will be at fullback. Butch Wolfuck, who was way below par in the first half, will start at tailback. He's 12 yards to pass the 1,000-yard mark for this year. Anthony Carter, the flanker, Vince Dean, the split in. We'll set the 3 or 4 year old in a moment. But no big changes there either. Now to give to Wolfen. Wolfen fires the middle. And again, Minnesota's waiting for him. Wolfen, who had a woeful first half by his standards, stopped by Jim Fonhorst and Kevin Kellen in the Minnesota defense. Offensive linemen for Michigan are Bubba Parrish and Ed Moransky, a tremendously awesome pair of tackles. Stephen Humphreys, Kurt Becker, the guards, Tom Dixon at center. There's Wolfuck, who set the all-time Michigan record. He passed up Rob Lytle last week, over 3,300 yards, but today he's had a very meager output, thanks to a swarming Minnesota defense. Second and 10. Here's a key by Smith. Smith fakes on the pitch out. Now Smith's going to be taken down by a great pursuit by Minnesota, led by Glenn Howard, the linebacker. And he'll get at most a yard on the play. Andre Harris was also there. So was Kevin Kellen. A whole host of maroon-shirted defenders. And it's spotted down. Well, they say he got to the 22. But it's second down and 10. Third down and 8.
You really have to, when you're running the option, or I should say defensing the option, you have to use that sideline as your 12th man on the field. You got to string the option out. You got to put a man on the quarterback and a man on the pitchback. That time Minnesota did a great job on that.
Well, Smith facing a big play here, third down and 8 to get his team out of the hole. He's made the big plays today for Michigan. And it is Smith rolling. Smith fires off and is broken up.
That's oh, no.
Flag down. Interference going to be called against Jim Fonhorst, who tried to go over the top of Stan Edwards, the intended receiver. And you heard Terry Hanratty say, oh, no, and I think I read your mind, Terry. You thought he played the ball.
I thought it was a great defensive play. Watch number 89, Jim Fonhorst, come in here. Smith tries to lay it over his head. Well, wait a minute. I think I got to agree with the official in seeing the rerun. He had a little body contact right before he hit the ball. The ball had not got to Edwards yet.
Another good call and a good break for Michigan. So that'll be a penalty right on the spot at the 24-yard line. And is automatic first down. Actually, didn't get the yardage for the first down, but pass interference does carry first down.
Those officials are too good for my eyes.
Out to the right, Anthony Carter. He's always a threat. Everything going to the right here for Michigan, and they hand it to the fullback. Edwards going hard, and they fumble, and they may be recovered by Minnesota. Minnesota players think they have the ball. You can see Glenn Cardelli jumping up and down, signaling our ball, but they did get away from Edwards. They've got to unstack them here to see who has the ball, the white shirt or the maroon shirt. And it is a white shirt. Michigan's ball. So Michigan recovers, and Cardelli's celebration was a little bit premature. Anthony Carter comes up with a loose ball. Talk about hands. Number one is used to handling the football. Well, that was another good break for Michigan. They could have coughed up the ball there, and Minnesota would have had it good for the spot. So the pass interference play with Minnesota failed to cover the fumble, and Michigan still got the ball at the 32. Loss of 3, the second and 13. Here's Smith, the Wolf.
Watch out.
Got room. Here comes, turns the corner of the 40. That's his best run of the day. Out of bounds in the 45. And it'll be first down for Michigan. Rick Whithouse and Glenn Cardelli made the stop. And here's Wolfuck moving closer and closer now to the 1,000-yard mark. Still not there, but he's close.
And again, they're so concentrating on Anthony Carter. Number one, you can't see him in the screen, but there's two men out there, which takes away the support man. Pat Carter gets a little block there, not much, but I'll tell you, and once you get Wolfolk out there with no support man. He's just going to gain yardage for you.
First and 10. Michigan has worked up to its 45-yard line. Getaway in motion. Here's the option again. Ought to hand it up the middle to Edwards. Nice fake in there by Smith. Edwards tries the middle. There's not much there. Stops short of the 50-yard line. Glenn Howard, the linebacker from Minnesota. And Anthony Davis, the right end. Davis has a little extra incentive here today because he is a native of Detroit playing against the Michigan team. Jerry DiOrio has replaced David Humphries in the guard for Michigan. He's still got Becker and Moransky on the right, and Boa Parrish is the huge big left tackle. Now here comes Wolfolk the other way, breaks a tackle. Wolfolk over the 50, 45, 40, taken out of bounds. Penalty flag is thrown back downfield. Woodhouse made the stop. There is a penalty flag down as Wolfolk got out of a trap that time. He was hit at the line of scrimmage or behind, but I think it's going to be erased from a penalty against Michigan.
There was misdirection. They pulled the two guards. You see Becker gets an excellent block, number 65, and Wolfolk breaks the tackle. I'll tell you, when you run a misdirection offense, a lot of times you get called for clipping because you're going against the grain.
Hey, Glenn Howard almost had him for a loss behind the line. There you can see what Michigan Wolfolk can do, but it went for naught here. This penalty will go the other way against Michigan. Holding penalty is the preliminary signal. Spotted down the 42. So it's second down coming up and 12 to go for Michigan at the 42-yard line. Michigan is fourth in all time in team victories, 623. Only three Ivy League teams have won more, Harvard, Yale, and Princeton. And of course, they go back a little bit before Michigan's time. Craig Dunaway's in there tight end. Here he comes over to the left side, trying to confuse the Minnesota defense. They like to switch strong and loop side in. There's a play action fake by Smith. He is coming down for the Bean, and it is caught by Bean at the 21-yard line. Vince Bean over the shoulder, a spectacular catch. Took it away of Glenn Cardelli, and the prettiest class play we've had today.
It really is because they had Carter to the wide side of the field. Now they're coming back with Bean. And actually, it's a great throw by Smith because he's putting it right between the dead spot of the zone. You see, the safety man didn't react well enough, Mike Robb, to the deep pattern because he was so concerned where Carter was.
Bean got the foot down in bounds. Last year, he was the backup for Carter. He's been moved out to split end. And this year, and you saw what he can do. First down, Michigan, and now the Wolverines threatening again at the Minnesota 21. Here's a pitch to Wolfolk. Wolfolk going outside with his feet, gets a block. Ball stopped from behind. Running it down was Rick Woodhouse, the safety. Wolfolk looked like he might have time to get out and turn the corner, and Woodhouse just made a super play from safety. And he stops him after a pickup of only two to the 19. Wolfolk still has not reached the 1,000-yard mark. He needs 12 yards here in the second half, and we'll try to keep you posted on that. Bo Schembechler along the sidelines, coach of the year 1969, and had the best record in the 70s of any college coach in America. Second and eight, it comes down the line. And again, the fullback, Edwards, hammers the middle, goes down close to the 15, and he's pounded back hard by the defense led by Anthony Davis and Glenn Seslevich. Seslevich, tough guy to move out of there. Number 34. There's Edwards. 32. 35 yards today for Wolfolk. So he needs one more. Well, he's just passed. He's 1,001 yards for the year. So Butch Wolfolk has passed that milestone. Third and five. A big play here for the Minnesota defense. And the blitz. And a quick fire to Bean. He drops it. Minnesota blitzing up the middle, and they put pressure immediately on Smith. He had to hurry his throw, and Bean couldn't make the cut. And it's fourth down. We may see the field goal try as Hajishik is coming on. Ali Hajishik.
Jim, number 26, Mike Robb, really put the pressure on Smith. As you said, a safety blitz right up the middle. Because Bean was out there all alone. If he had just a split second more, he could have got the ball to him.
Hajishik, who is 2 for 5 in field goals, is 1 for 1 today. And this try will be from about 33 yards. Right in the middle. Hajisheik, the kick up, it's long enough, and it is good. Hajisheik has hit one from 32 yards. And so Michigan up to lead now to 13 points. It becomes 20-7. Minnesota will be looking for the kickoff when we come back. Now Michigan widened its lead. It's the Wolverines 20 and the Gophers 7.
Does your house have enough insulation? Good. Have you seen what's happened to fuel costs lately? To fight back, get up in your attic and add an extra layer of Owens Corning fiberglass insulation. Don't wait. Put your house in the pink. With Owens Corning fiberglass insulation today, it's cheaper than you know what.
High in the mountains of France, in a laboratory like no other, Timex has created the Mean Machine. Watch a test this Time Commander Digital. See how tough a test this Time Commander can pass. When you wear your Timex, it will probably never have to endure this kind of stress and strain. The Mean Machine shows, no matter how advanced Timex is always Timex. It takes a licking and keeps on and on.
Well, Michigan took the opening kickoff of the second half. They didn't give it up. They used it almost 5 minutes before they finally scored. There's number eight is Kerry Glenn. Also back there is Teddy Watson instead of Manny Henry. Butch Wolfolk, as we told you, is going over the 1,000-yard mark in rushing for the second straight year. He's only the fourth Michigan back to do that. Ron Johnson, Rob Blotto, and Gordon Bell. Not even Tom Harmon was able to do that back in the time he won the Heisman Trophy. And his great battles here, by the way, with the All-Stars, Bruce Smith of Minnesota. What great fights they had back in another era. Those Butch, over the 1,000-yard mark, although he's not having a super day on the day. Here's Watson, 1 yard deep, going to run it out. At the 10, Watson breaks one tackle, but he's right in the arms of another man, Jim Herman, and he will take him down short of the 15-yard line. So he loses 6 yards by not staying in the end zone. Minnesota will start at 14, first and 10.
I'll tell you, Hajisheik has quite a leg on him because he's kicking in a pretty good wind here, and he kicked it so high right to the goal line that, you know, they had to return it, and good coverage by Michigan.
Well, Bell, by far, is his best day kicking. He's kicked two for two in field goals. He was one for four coming in here just for the season. 52,875, that's the attendance for the game today at Memorial Stadium. Jacobs and Henry, the setbacks behind Hoynesy. This is the first time Minnesota's had the ball second half. Hoynesy, play action fake. Hoynesy all day. Fires the corner. He's grabbed over by Jacobs with flat. He slips a tackle. Still got room to the 20. And he is up to the 25-yard line. And first down, I believe, for Minnesota on some super running over there by Frank Jacobs. Stopped finally by Brian Carpenter. Ball Gergash, we understand now the way he likes it. Make the stop. There are the signals.
Hoynesy wanted to do was throw the ball downfield, but he let the defense get back. You know, Gergasher just overran the ball. And Jordan made a good cut to the inside. Jacobs did. But.
Well, it was the first down. It's second down of about a foot. Let's see if Hoynesy wants to try and pull something here. Nope, he gets his fullback breaking through. The first down is Henry. Manny Henry gets the first down and then some. After the 30 and beyond the 31-yard line, Mike Boren, the linebacker. Makes the tackle for Michigan with Tony Jackson, the free safety. Another first down for Minnesota. Their first of the second half. Well, the Minnesota showing some life here, coming out of a hole as they trail 27. And we're in the third period with 9 minutes to go. So far, Hoynesy has not been able to team up with Chester Cooper on anything long. And blitz by Michigan. Hoynesy trying to get away. Back. 30.
Oh, all right.
Hoynesy at the 50. Hoynesy still going. And he's to the 43-yard line of Michigan. Tony Jackson was the last man to stop Mike Hoynesy, which he did. That saved a touchdown. But what a brilliant run by Mike Hoynesy.
Well, Jim, that's why you have to get Mike Hoynesy in the ballgame, whether he's throwing the ball or running it. I mean, Michigan had great pressure. They had the blitz on. Two or three guys had a shot at him. And now he has the presence of mind, knowing there's a blitz, there's man-to-man coverage downfield, so there's not that many secondary people down there.
Terry
picks up a lot of real estate.
Did you ever look like that running when you were a quarterback?
No.
Not very many.
Younger days, I did.
He looked like a halfback running that ball. He's a hand off the tailback. Jacobs up the middle of the 40. Penalty flag thrown. Marker is down, so hold everything. Another penalty could be forthcoming. It could be holding here on Minnesota. Clay Miller was in there to stop the play, and Minnesota's trudging back toward the huddle, and it is legal use of the hands against Minnesota. That'll be 10 yards on the Gophers. And so the drive momentarily slowed down here by Minnesota as they get into Michigan territory.
Bo with a thumbs up.
Give them a signal. That's the way to go, boys. Bo, I'm sure we'll have a few run backs when they play the film of that run, though, a moment ago, because Mike Boren had Boise right in his grasp when he got away. Right here, penalty it is. They go use the hands. Just remind you very quickly here, coming up NHL hockey, Toronto Maple Leafs against the Colorado Rockies Friday, November the 6th. NHL season's underway on ESPN. You can see all the action here on your Total Sports Network. First down, about 12 from the 45. Play action roll out, and here's a flip over to Jacobs, but right through his hands. Jacobs might have taken his eye off the ball because Keith Bosick, strong safety, was really bearing down. Incomplete pass, third down now, and 12, third down, 11.
Jacobs is very lucky he didn't catch that ball.
Yeah, that's Bosick had him measured.
Right there.
Bostic is second team all Big Ten last year, so it popped you. Cooper is to the right. He's got the wide part of the field. Passing situation for Hoynsey. There he goes. Hoynsey, look. Hoynsey all day.
He has a whole field.
Yep, he's going to get some yardage. 30, 25, 20, and he ducks and dives to the 22. Boy, what a tough kid. The Bruins Samoy from Hawaii. And he puts on another blast here to the delight of his happy Minnesota crowd. Evan Cooper on the stop. Another first down, Minnesota.
I tell you, Michigan is going to have to do something about that because they're leaving him uncovered. They're doubling everybody on the outside. Good protection by the offensive line and enabling the defense to get their drops, and he just turns upfield for a lot of real estate.
OMZ has got Cooper out again to the wide side of the field to the right and Wickbacker to the left. Give it a tailback. Up the middle, Jacobs inside the 20-17. Frank Jacobs, leading rusher for Minnesota, stopped by Al Sinsich, freshman nose guard. Ball is down the Michigan 17-yard line. Second down, about 4-yard gain on that play. Minnesota threatening to score a second touchdown against Michigan. I don't know how long it's been since Michigan gave up two touchdowns. They had not given up any in 10 quarters since the Michigan State game.
Well, not a bad time for a draw right here.
Well, it's a little quick handoff instead to Manny Henry, and Mike Boren closed down quickly on him. Might have gotten a yard.
They see number one and number six. Now they're going to start going to work as soon as they get the play. So these guys stay loose in the sideline.
Yeah, only one of them is the live man. The first signal they give is which signal is to count. Well, Owens, he must have picked it up. Third down, here's a big play for Minnesota.
Got to have a rollout to the right-hand side. Use that wide side of the field.
They need the touchdown. He comes rolling out. He fires, and he was caught here, but it will not be a first down, I think. Frank Jacobs gets it, but Paul Gergash, who's been all over the field today, number 50, makes the stop for Michigan. Minnesota fans are saying, go for it.
I've never seen a crowd say, no, don't go.
They don't have a one-year contract, though, either, do they?
Think of what happened there, Jim, with Hoynsey. He really didn't put pressure on the defense. He threw the ball just a little too quick. He's got to roll out there, so he has the ability to run the ball.
All right, there is a timeout called by Minnesota. They're going to talk it over at least with 6:55 to go. 5:55. Michigan leads 27. All right, they are bringing Jim Gallery on the field, Minnesota is, which might signal that Joe Salem wants the field goal. Get some points on the board. He's down by 13 points. Field goal would cut it to 10. And there's lots of time left in this game. Always, of course, could be a fake, although the holder is not necessarily a passer, Ron Wickbacher. Try would be of 31 yards, the 21-yard line. Gowrie, who missed one chance today that really wasn't much of a chance, 52 yards into the wind. He had been 8 out of 10 coming in here. This one is up and plenty long enough, and it is wide. Gowrie has missed, so Minnesota's long march brings them up empty-handed. They get no score out of it, and it is still 27 Michigan. So you got to credit the Michigan defense, although that time it was just the inability of Gowrie to hit the field goal, what should have been a fairly easy range for him.
Yeah, and plus he had the wind to his back, Jim, so he didn't have a problem there much long enough, but it was just a little bit off.
Now Michigan takes over at the 20. First and 10. Steve Smith, Stan Edwards, Anthony Carter, Butch Woolfolk, Vince Dean, that's the offensive striking force that Michigan has on the field. It's played just about the entire game. Smith played all the way, Edwards has played all the way. Woolfolk was out for one or two plays. They give it to Woolfolk. Woolfolk coming to the left side, powers up to the 24. Short game. He's second down and 6. Von Horst and Glenn Howard stopping for Minnesota.
Jim, at the top of the show, we mentioned that maybe Michigan's offensive line with the size would just blow out Minnesota, but it really hasn't been that today. They haven't used 60 pounds plus per man to their advantage.
Second down and 6, Michigan from their 24. Michigan leads 20-7. Woolfolk again comes outside, crosses the 25, and runs into Glenn Howard. And he's taken down right there. Michigan and his famed wing helmet, which was designed by Fritz Preisler, one of the great coaches for Michigan. Boy, both these schools have had an outstanding list of players. We mentioned Tom Harmon and Bruce Smith. Well, Minnesota's had Bronco Nagurski, Leo Mammolini, Carl Eller, among others. And Michigan, of course, Elroy Crazy Legs Hurts, Deerdorf, Rob Lytle, we mentioned a moment ago, his record. Pretty fair coaches came out of this spot here in Minnesota, too, here. How about Bud Grant, Bud Wilkinson? Okay.
Bud, we know well. Open.
In motion goes Dunaway. And again, keep us by Smith. And he's maybe a first down. Boy, Terry Smith has shown us that we've seen some super quarterbacking play for both teams. Would you agree with that?
We really have. And that time, it was really interesting play because obviously they're seeing that Minnesota is reacting too much to that, to the option. Take a look at it now. We're going to see Smith. It's a good read. Now, you see the whole Michigan defense is, or I'm sorry, Minnesota's defense is bearing off to the left there. And Smith just gets the ball and comes back, and realizing he only needed about a yard and a half, 2 yards.
Anthony Davis with Mike Robb helping out a little bit. His Rover backs back in Minnesota. It's a first down Michigan at the 30. Dunaway in motion. There's again, they send Wolf at this time around the left side with misdirection. Runs out of real estate around the 35, so he isn't going to get much from there. Glenn Cardelli. Moransky really wiped out with a block that time, but there just wasn't enough field here for Wolf.
And Jim, it's the second time they used today. First time they got caught for a holding penalty. They're using just a misdirection. Overshift, or, you know, they're pulling some guards out there. They want Minnesota to go to the wide side, which they're doing, and come back with Wolfo.
Number one is on. You see Anthony Carter just trotted into the picture. So Carter, he's the buzz bomb. He's back in for Michigan to the right side, top of your screen. Second down, fullback gets the call, and Edwards is straightened up by Jim Farnhorst and slammed down after maybe a yard or two at the most to the 37. That'll be a third down play for Michigan and 3. Minnesota defense been on the field a lot here in this quarter, Terry.
They really have, and I think, you know, I don't think it'll affect them too much because, you know, it's such a gorgeous day here. You know, at that age, you can run forever.
Again, Carter goes to the top of your screen to the right. It's third, short yardage. Edwards and Wolfolk here behind Smith. And it is Smith play action. Smith looking, comes downfield to Bean, and is caught out of bounds at the Minnesota 45. Lynn Cardella covering, but Bean just ran a perfect route right to the sidelines, kept his foot in bounds, and made the catch.
And what they're doing there is that, you know, they're doing a little roll by Smith. Now, look, this is an outstanding job by Bean of keeping his feet in the bounds there. You see, he just dragged his left foot right at the last second. A good call by the official. That was a close one.
That was close. Brent Harms now has replaced Carl Mecklenburg at right tackle for Minnesota. So they have Orgas, Kellen, Harms, and Davis now in the line. Again, the fullback takes it to the right as he slammed down hard. Oh, he is really jarred, and that was Glenn Howard who put him down. But that's as hard as Edwards or anybody else have been hit today. Ooh, what a hit. Down the 45. No gain, second and 10. I lost a foot. Number three here is for Minnesota defense is Glenn Howard, who made that stop. He's the defensive captain, so I'm calling the play. Double coverage again on Carter. Smith back, and Smith is looking the other way, coming down.
Watch
to Bean
out.
And broken up by Glenn Cardelli. They were going to Bean, and Cardelli at that time had it mentioned. Incomplete pass, third down 10 now for Michigan, and Minnesota's defense now is holding well in this series.
Now this is just a bad pass by Smith. He throws it a little too high and behind him. You want to get the receiver, you want to throw it to the outside like you did before. It's the same pass play. Bean had him there. If you throw the ball low into the outside, he gets the completion. Good defense by Cardelli.
You know, against the rush, this Minnesota defense only given up 130 yards, 121 yards a game in its Big Ten games. And Michigan been rushing for almost 300 yards a game, so there's quite a matchup there. And Michigan's doing well, but then Minnesota's come through in this series. Here's the last third and 10. Smith over the middle, and it's incomplete. Should have been caught. That was intended for Vince Bean, and Mike Robb was defending. And it's fourth down. The Michigan punting team comes on. Clock shows 2.5 minutes to go in the third period. The Wolverines have dominated the ball for the most part in this period, with except a one drive. There's Carter, who might have been open on the play. Let's see.
I tell you, you know, a lot of times you get into a rut where you're thinking, you know, they're going to double cover him, so he's not going to be open. But a lot of times, you know, a great receiver like that can shake two guys.
Well, he had Andre Harris beaten there, that's for sure. Don Bracken in the punt for Michigan. And it's another one that is almost straight up in the air. Now it takes another good bounce. Taken by a Minnesota player. Oh, what a dangerous play that is. That was Marvell Ross. I think he may be in there. Nope, could have been him. Well, we'll be right back. Michigan leads 20-7 over Minnesota. Part of the crowd here today of over 52,000 watching this game at Memorial Stadium, the old brick house in Minneapolis. And what a gorgeous day we've had. October, late October, and 63 degrees. Bob Stroud now is in the backfield at fullback for Minnesota. Tailback is for Jacobs. They give it to Jacobs. Jacobs to the right side, hammers his way for a couple of tough yards. Michigan gives grudgingly here on the ground. Walter Ross, that was. Ross made the run, and Mike Hammerstein the stop.
Jim, we have just about 2 minutes to go here in the third quarter, you know, 20-7. I think, you know, the defense of Minnesota has played extremely well against Michigan. But the odd thing is the offense has to get something going right now because they need a few scores here.
There was the play flashed in from the sidelines. Joe Salem using his backup quarterbacks for that beauty. Wide left is Chester Cooper.
Normally they're passing formations, footbacks.
Austin Stroop for the backs. Hoenstein drops him straight over the middle. Caught with a tight end Carroll for first down. Drops around the 31. Well, it may not be a first down. It's right on the yard line. Now they're saying he's down at about the 30 and a half yard line, which will be a half yard short. So it'll be third and one, and it's actually less than a yard to go. It was a good catch by Carroll.
It really was, and it really showed the quick arm of Mike Hoenstein.
There's Carroll from Monona. He's replaced the Mike Curtis. Minnesota's not going to the tight end nearly so much since Curtis was out with an ankle injury. He's their first string tight end, and he is not quite ready to return. Well, they've messed up that. There goes some movement, Minnesota. If Minnesota didn't move, Michigan was offsides and did make contact, but there's a possibility that that Minnesota might have moved to the line. Let's see what the decision is here. It is illegal procedure against Michigan. So encroachment is called on the Wolverines. They did make contact before the snap. 5-yard penalty will give Minnesota a first down. Well, now Minnesota brings back its wide receivers, Weckbacher and Cooper. They have two tight ends in, and Michigan is warming up B.J. Dickey, a backup quarterback to Steve Smith. Smith's had a brilliant afternoon, but Michigan has a good lead right now, 20-7. We're in the final minute of the third period. Minnesota threatened earlier in this quarter. Got down close, but on 4th and 2, went for the field goal and missed. Owensy can run. Owensy heading for the sidelines, out of bounds in the 45. That'll be close to another first down. Paul Gergash ran him out for Michigan with 52 seconds to go in the quarter. And it's close to another first down for Minnesota. Hey, Hoynesy may wind up the leading rusher today for Minnesota.
Well, I think he will. I think he'll be the leading rusher in the ballgame today. He's had about 3 or 4 good runs tonight.
They're bringing the chains over. You know, we're going to be picking the Vitalis player of the game, and thinking about it, Smith's had a great game. We've never had a player off a losing team win it, have we?
Never have. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen any most valuable player off a losing team.
First down for Minnesota. But Hoynesy is having some performance. 52 seconds. That's in the third period. Well, this game's got quite a ways to go. Michigan has scored the only touchdown of the period. They drove from the second half kickoff, a long sustained drive, almost 5 minutes. Went in to score on the pass from Smith to the fullback Edwards. Nick Davidson now is coming in to split in, replacing Weckbacher. And they move Ross out in the slot. There's a blitz. They pick it up, and the pass is caught over the 50 by Keith Bostic. Or rather, Bostic made the stop. Caught over the middle by Walter Ross out of the backfield. Bostic really came over the top. I was surprised he didn't get the yellow flag on that one.
If you notice, he hesitated right at the last second, you know, to prevent the interference.
Good position there by Walter Ross, who's sort of been in Joe Salem's doghouse in and out the last week or two. Outstanding junior running back. Second down and 5 for Minnesota. Now they're Michigan territory. Fake flip to give up the ball. Ross got room inside the 35-yard line of Michigan, a first down to the 31. What a beautiful fake on the pitch by Hoynesy. Instead of pitching, he put it right in the breadbasket of Walter Ross and looked at the open.
And I'll tell you what, that was shit. He had Michigan going crazy. You see the linebackers there all flowing for the pitch. Little misdirection for Minnesota. I figure since Michigan can do it, they're trying in their playbook.
Tony Jackson kept that play from going even further at its first down at the Michigan 32 as the period ends. That's the end of the third quarter. Michigan still in the lead. Minnesota now beginning to move. It is Michigan 20, Minnesota 7 with a quarter to go. Now for the fourth and final period. And we'll be looking here for Hoynesy to go more and more in the air. It's been the year of the pass, Terry Hanratty. Looks like the NCAA is going to set a new record this year in passing. Almost 322 yards a game by both teams. Well, we'll tell you about some fighting coming up. Pino Cuevas against Roger Stafford. That'll be for the WBA Welterweight Championship. Or he is the champion, that is. Former champion, Cuevas. So that's on ESPN November 7th, live on Saturday. 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific time from the Hacienda Hotel in Las Vegas. 32-yard line of Michigan. Minnesota on the roof with Strauss and Ross in the backfield. Hoynesy off to Ross. Ross grabs it inside the 30-yard line. He goes down to the 28. It's going to be about 4 yards in the play. Walter Ross is a junior from St. Petersburg, Florida, stopped by Carlton Rose. So there was Ross stopped by Rose. Ross, a speedster.
I think Minnesota, you know, is mixing everything up so well now, Jim. They're, you know, Hoynesy is rolling out. He's looking downfield. He wants to go downfield, but he's not making the dumb mistake by throwing into coverage, which he did force a couple in the early part of the game. But instead, he just dumped it off his back, so he's 5 or 6 yard catches. And that's why they move the ball down the field.
This is Chester Cooper here, the big threat from Minnesota, who's been has been heard from today that much. Out to the left side. And a give up to the middle to Strout. Bob Strout, the Minnesota fullback, runs right into Al Sensich, the nose guard. He makes a stop at 26.
You know, and again, another mix-up, you know, in their offense for Minnesota, because they never really ran the ball from that formation. So they're giving them different looks to Michigan. That time Michigan was up for the cause.
Third down, I call it about three to go for first down. More like three and a half. See what Hornsey can come up with here on third down. And he fakes inside. He goes again on the handoff to Strout. And this time Michigan's defense is not going to be fooled. Tony Osmond drove Strout all the way back to the 30-yard line. They'll give him his forward motion, which was down to the 25. Here's another decision now by Joe Salem. Team trailing by 13 points in the fourth quarter and facing fourth down and three.
You got to go for it.
Outside the 25. Michigan sending in three new defensive players. Looking for the pass here from Hoynes. Hoynes has been quite a threat running today also. Michigan set up with a zone double coverage here on Cooper. Minnesota's got to get 3 yards this time. Hoynsey rushed. Hoynsey fires, and it's incomplete. Something went wrong there. He fired over the head of his intended receiver. Looked like Cooper down around the 15-yard line, and Michigan will take over. Osmond almost got to Hoynsey and might have rushed him a little bit. Minnesota line is protected brilliantly all day for Hoynsey, but that time Osmond broke through. And Michigan takes over now. They've stopped another Minnesota threat. It'll be Michigan ball at the Wolverines 25, first and 10. And the Wolverines leading 20-7 now with 12 minutes and 47 seconds to go. So they can pick up some first downs here. That's going to look more and more in the favor of the maize and blue. Wolford, Carter, and Edwards behind Smith. It's the first unit in for Michigan in the backfield. Wolford. Middle of the
road. Oh, there he goes.
Yep. To the 40. Wolford, 45-50. Turns outside and gets down to Minnesota 43. That's the best run of the day by Butch Wolfolk, the All-American halfback from Michigan, stopped by Glenn Cardelli. And it was Anthony Carter that gave him this really good key block that sprung him down into Minnesota territory.
A guy like Wolfolk, you know it's only a matter of time before he's going to break one, because he has such tremendous acceleration. He reads his holes extremely well. They put him deep in that eye so he can, you know, see the whole line of scrimmage, and he can cut back and go straight ahead, whatever he needs to do.
Well, he's had some great days against Minnesota. 131 as a freshman, 194 as a sophomore, 73 last year before he was hurt, 398 yards and 5 touchdowns in the 3 previous games, and now that was his best run here today. They kept him in check for the Minnesota Tech. Quick pass out to Anthony Carter. Carter trying to get on the outside. They'll be taken out of bounds around the 35-yard line. Glenn Cardelli. Carter, who just goes out there in the flat and stops.
Just a little hitch pattern, Jim. All he wants to do is get about 2 yards, give the quarterback a throwing lane, and then he's one-on-one on Cardelli, and that's got to be a scary approach to the football game.
Well, you don't dare crowd him because he gives a little fake and go, and it's 6. Brent Harms now comes in again, replacing Mecklenburg in the line for Minnesota. Norm Betts is back in a tight end for Michigan, replacing Dunaway. Second down about a yard for Smith. Gives it to his fullback, and Edwards has got the first down. Workmanlike fashion, he plods on down around the 32. Jimmy James halts him there with Glenn Howard. And that'll be a Michigan first down. And so the Wolverines are doing what they want to do here. They keep the clock rolling. They keep moving with a 13-point lead, and the clock shows now less than 12 and a half minutes to go.
Jim, it's really something to see when you see Anthony Carter to the wide side of the field. Minnesota's whole secondary shifts over to him.
Good luck there at Steve Smith, the young sophomore who's like Hoynsey, his counterparts had an outstanding day. And the Wolfer. Wolfer now stacked up around the 30. Brent Harms, the first to hit him. Harms, the guy who replaced Carl Mecklenburg at right tackle. So the Minnesota defense, which last week allowed to Iowa just 45 yards and only two first downs in the first half, found a different story here with Michigan. Boy, a high-geared offensive role. Tom Hassel now at fullback. Stan Edwards comes out for the first time today. Norm Betts is back in a tight end. He's brought in the play. So now it is Hassel, a sophomore from Cincinnati, number 48. Here's a fullback in front of Wolfram. Give it to Wolfram. Wolfram is running into trouble. Turn the corner. And it does get it down to 25. That's a pretty good running job by Wolfram, who was hemmed in from the very beginning. Rick Whithouse stopped him, with us. So Wolfram now beginning to pile up some yardage. He was held to something like 10 or 12 yards in the first half, but passed the 1,000 mark for the season here early in the second half, and now he's had a couple of pretty good runs. At the 25, it'll be Michigan ball, third down and three. Now clock shows 10:45 to go in the game. Michigan leads 20-7. Smith, head down, going to the air to Anthony Carter, end zone, and it is touchdown. What a super catch by Anthony Carter. Cardelli and Woodhouse were both back there, but the ball was just perfectly thrown by Steve Smith. That's his third touchdown pass of the afternoon, and Michigan now has a commanding lead of 26-7.
I'll tell you, you really can't get a better throw than what Smith did right there. And Carter ran a fantastic, but before they were running these post patterns to him. Now they ran to the corner, and that time he wasn't open by much. It was pretty good defense back there, but just a super throw by Smith.
That's the 10th touchdown pass of the season for Steve Smith, and it is also Carter's 28th career touchdown. His fifth for this year. Haji Sheik in to try for the point. There's Haji Sheik's kick. He's been perfect today. So we'll be back in a moment, but Michigan has up its lead. Michigan 27 and Minnesota 7. Well, Michigan has struck again, but let's take a look at this play here to Anthony Carter. Why is he in bounds in the end zone? Official says yes.
It's a little semi roll. You're going to see it's going to drop it right over the head. I believe he's got it there.
Yeah. And all you have to, in the end, you see the ball going away, but
that's after that.
All he has to have is possession.
Yeah, that ball dropping is after the fact.
Once he has possession in the end zone, it's over. It is an immediate touchdown. That's what it was for Anthony Carter, the 28th of his career, and the fifth one for this year. Haji Sheik will kick off. Scoring drive for Michigan was an impressive one. They were just trying to run off some time, so they ran off 2 minutes, 11 seconds. They picked up 7 points in the bargain on the 25-yard touchdown pass to Anthony Carter, and Michigan now maybe will put the game away 27-7. Back deep, Teddy Watson is waiting, along with Kerry Glenn. It's going to be Glenn deep in the end zone, and he'll decide to keep it right there. So Minnesota will come out to the 20 to start their drive with 10 minutes and 36 seconds on the clock, and trailing by 20. It's the biggest margin held by Michigan in the game at 27-20. Wolverines now looking very strong as they head down the stretch. Michigan considered in this unusual tight Big Ten race to have the toughest row to hoe, as it were, in the final section, because Michigan must play after today Illinois, Purdue, and Ohio State, all contenders in the Big Ten race. Ross and Stroud are the running backs now behind Mike Hoynsey. Boy, Hoynsey has been brilliant here. Even if Minnesota should lose, they've had an outstanding day. Now Ross goes to tailback. Hoynsey blitz, sidelines, Cooper right to his hands. A little bit high, but Cooper got his hands up, couldn't hold it. Brian Carpenter was blitzing in on Hoynsey. Oh, no, Carpenter was covering. That was Lemeron.
And I tell you, he put a lick on Hoynsey that time.
Second and 10. Clock stop with 10:32 to go. Last week, Minnesota's moment to shine against Iowa, and now here's Michigan coming into Minnesota, and looks like the Wolverines going to come away in an impressive win. Hoynsey always a threat. Stands in there. Drills that ball complete. Caught up around the 35-yard line. One of his running backs, I think it's Walter Ross, let's see.
First down.
Out of the second. Nope, that is Cooper. Chester Cooper. makes the catch. Brian Copper in the stop.
Watch Hosey. I love the way he just sits back in that pocket, surveys the whole field before he's ready to fire. Now he's going to find Cooper right in the dead spot of the zone. Now he does a good job of working away from the cornerback and the linebacker to find that spot.
It's the first down for Minnesota. 10 minutes to go in the game, and Michigan leads 27-7. Hoensy stands in there again. Now he drills it one more time. And it's caught by Bob Straub, hit down by Brian Carver, short of the 40. That'll be a short pickup. Time getting away here, but Michigan defense giving grudgingly here to Minnesota. Off an outstanding performance by Mike Hoensy, a junior quarterback, a junior college All-American from Mount San Antonio College in California. What a day he's having here, maybe in a losing cause. Second down play for Hoensy. Good protection, drills to the sidelines. Cooper cannot get it. Going a little bit off the mark with Carpenter covering again. Cooper's had Carpenter one-on-one a couple of times. And that time, Hoensy could not get the ball on the mark. Nick Davidson comes in replacing Cooper.
Jim, I'm really surprised they haven't tried to go deep with Cooper, because he has the outstanding speed. They're just trying to throw him the medium rounds, the hooks, the outs, and, you know, about 12 to 15 yards.
Plus, Minnesota leads for the big play. They're trailing by 20. Third down play here by Hoensy. He needs six to just keep possession. And he's hit over the middle of Straub. Straub has the first down. He's to the Michigan 40 and inside to the 39. Carlton Rose and Tony Jackson picks them both to stop Bob Straub. Straub, a junior fullback who had been switched to tailback this week off the injury by Jacobs. Jacobs then had a quick recovery, got back in the lineup, so Straub had to go back to the sidelines. But here in the second half, he's been in. Now Manny Henry comes in replacing him. Bo Schembechler just shakes his head. He's got a great defensive team, but they have not been able to completely contain Minnesota. Nick Davidson back in the line for the goal.
Safety blitz.
Yep, there's Hoensy. Fires it up in the air, and it is.
That's a touchdown.
Davidson falls. Hit by body. Davidson catches it for the touchdown. The rather bizarre play for Minnesota. But it ends up in the six-pointer. That's it again, after the tip.
Michigan, look, see the safety man coming up the middle there. And Hoensy had to get rid of the ball. He knew he had his receiver out there. What you do, one-on-one, you got to have faith in your receiver that he can take it away from that defensive back. And that time, Davidson just did an outstanding job. Put the ball up in the air a little bit, then took it in for a touchdown.
And so Minnesota keeps the last gasp hope alive. Jim Gallery in the try of the point. Minnesota now could cut it to 13 again. It's 27-13. The Gallery's kick is good. And it becomes 27-14. Nope, it is not good. It was wide, plenty high enough, but it did miss. So Gallery uncharacteristically misses on the try for point. And so it's a 14-point margin, but wait a minute, there might have been a penalty. Calling the play back. Or they, well, I thought they're going to call the play back. It just might have been an injury. So it is. Okay, we'll have the kickoff coming up. And so it remains a 14-point lead for Michigan. Michigan 27, Minnesota 13. And we'll be right back for the kickoff, maybe an onsider. Now another look here at Terry Hanratty at Hoensy, and you said he had to throw it up in desperation.
Hoensy, he was smart enough to read that blitz. Then he'd got to realize he knows where his receivers are. You see Davidson, he just did a little flick of the ball, took it away from body back there, and I'll tell you what, just an outstanding play for a receiver.
Time remaining, 8 minutes and 50 seconds. Is it onside time or not, Terry?
It's got to be onside. You see Michigan, what they're going to put up there now is what you call your hands team. That means all the little numbers and the 80 numbers, the guys who are used to handling the football. You're not going to find any 60s, 50s, or 70s out there.
It was Marion Boddy being helped off the field. He was injured on the try on the point after try. Junior was leading interceptor last year for Michigan, making his third start here because they got players like Carpenter, who's been hurt a lot. Back deep, Anthony Carter, and he's the only deep safety for Michigan. nine players are between the 40 and the 50. Then they got sort of a short safety around the 30. And then Carter back at the 15. And there's a bounding kick that's going to come all the way back to Carter. Scoops up at the 12.
Watch out. Look at that.
40. 35, 40. Still going. 45. Hit from behind and down on the 47. Another great return by Anthony Carter as Minnesota was just trying to bounce that ball into a Michigan player. It missed everybody going all the way back to Carter, and he rolled it back to the 47. Boy, give Carter some time to get under steam, and it could be trouble. Here's the scoring drive for Minnesota. 80 yards in just a minute, 46. Shows you how quickly things can happen. Six plays, now 27-13. Might ask why Minnesota didn't go for two. They really didn't need 2 points at the time. Lawrence Ricks now has replaced Wolfolk, and Tom Hassel is the fullback, so Bo Schimpeck, they're getting the second line running backs a shot, but he's still sticking with Steve Smith. It's to Ricks. Ricks is an opening over Ed Moransky and Kurt Becker. They did their job on the line. Then Glenn Howard, the linebacker, closed it down, but it's a gain of 4 or 5 yards for Lawrence Ricks. He's gained only 267 yards this year, but he had 126 of them against Northwestern last week. There's the carries he's had. Almost 5 yards of carry. As we said, he got just about half of his yardage last week. Had a great game against Northwestern. John Wood is in defensively at left end, facing Fred Orgas for Minnesota. Now he'll get again to Rex, cutting back against the grain as he'll be spilled around the 45 of Minnesota, close to first down. Anthony Davis, a name that has sort of familiar ring to it, doesn't it? Makes a stop in Minnesota.
Jim, I was fortunate enough to do three Michigan games last year for ESPN, and I saw a lot of Lawrence Ricks, and he is quite a tailback. You know, if he wasn't playing behind Butch Wolfolk, he'd be playing a lot of football somewhere.
Well, he'll be back next year, and so will Anthony Carter, and so will Vince Bean, and so will Steve Smith. So Schimpeck will have some offensive guns returning for next year, and he's not through this year yet. There's a give in the middle to Hassel, to Glenn Howard making the stop. They're just trying for the first down here. Keep the clock rolling with 7 minutes, 18 seconds to go. Michigan has all the margin it needs in scoring. 14-point lead. There's the time, 7:18. Going back to Carter's touchdown, we told you it was his 28th career touchdown, 26 by reception. It puts him third best in the Big Ten history now with 26 touchdowns by pass reception. He trails Dave Young of Purdue at 27, so he's about to tie him in the next one. And then Jay Butcher of Indiana, who holds the Big Ten record of 30. So that's very much in the reach of Carter before this year's over. And Carter's got next year.
First down for Michigan, so they're just going to crank up that machine.
7 minutes and 18 seconds to go on the clock here in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Steve Smith is going to be a very strong candidate for MVP, I feel sure. Back on the field with the play, and Michigan down to the Minnesota 43 first down. Anthony Carter is in there. He's to the left side. I think Michigan might just keep it on the ground here. Here comes Smith, the option. Smith rolling, tries to stay in bounds, and he does. Inside the 40-yard line, Glenn Howard rolls him out. Howard, for a guy coming off ankle surgery, has played well today.
Second down, six.
4 yard gain, second and six.
Yeah, I've been impressed all day long with Minnesota's defense. I thought they played extremely well. And to hold Wolfolk, what he's done so far today, you know, I think just an outstanding job. He only had the one real big run.
Well, I think without a doubt that the defense is Minnesota's strong point. They had held Big Ten teams to 121 yards rushing. I think Minnesota and Michigan could be over that, perhaps. But not by a lot. Fred Brockington now is in his career. And again, up the middle to Ricks, and Ricks gets a little bit of a breathing room, and he fires right through to the 30. Another first down for Michigan. Carl Mecklenburg trips up Larry Ricks. Another first down for the Wolverines. Well, perhaps it'll be another trip to Pasadena here for the Maize and Blue. Last year they went out and defeated Washington. And they're not out of the Big Ten race yet, although they've got some playing to do.
All day long, you know, they've opened up nice hole. You see the fullback leading in there. Now you're going to see number 46. Ricks, who would have come into your picture there.
Here's Ricks again. Ricks now runs into trouble. Penalty flag down. Penalty flag down. Thrown in the area where it might be a clip against Michigan. John Wood. Minnesota tackle. Holding or clipping is holding, I guess. That's the...
Tim, I don't think there's any question. I think Michigan definitely has the best offensive line in college football. I think they have three guys in there that could be, you know, potentially great pro ball players. They are great college ball players. And I'll tell you what, they do some blocking up there, whether they're blocking for the pass, the option, or just, you know, the straight blocking up the middle.
Becker, Moransky, and Paris. I doubt there's a team in America with a better threesome than that. Tackles on the ground.
I'll tell you, Betts, number 82, the tight end, is one quite a blocker also.
There's an outstanding, brilliant young guy, too. Academic All-American last year in the Big Ten.
That's what they used to say about me.
Yeah.
You talk about academics. On the other end of the stick.
No, that's not true. By the way, this is the 49th straight game Michigan has scored. The last time they were shut out was by Minnesota. That was back in 1977. Here's Smith looking. Blitz on. Smith fires over the middle.
Oh,
it's got it inside the 15. Anthony Carter on a pass that was perfectly thrown by Steve Smith just as he was being hit, and Glenn Cardelli could not cover number one again.
What no way you cover him one-on-one. I tell you, who says that Bo Schembechler was conservative?
Nope, not
there
on
he
that
is.
Count. You forget
14
it.
14 points up, controlling the ball with 5:20 to go, and he puts a post pattern on him.
You know, he has a career average of over 16 yards to catch, Carter. And I think the NCAA record is like 13, held by Jenny Rogers, a 72 Heisman Trophy winner from Nebraska. So Carter has a good chance before he's through it, Michigan, to break him down. Here's the play action fake, and they give it a fullback. Hassel. Hassel's inside the 10.
And again, that offensive line just blowing them up.
Well, Michigan, in the process of running out the clock in the second half, it looks like going to score another touchdown. They're inside the 10-yard line of Minnesota. Carter now has 8 catches for 152 yards. And he had 9 catches for 142 last year, so that's almost 300 yards in receiving just the last 2 games against Minnesota alone. And Carter isn't finished today. Here comes Smith. Smith keeping, cuts to 5. Smith still driving to the 2. Michigan, and we mentioned, had a tough road at home, the Big Ten. They've got to play Illinois. They have to play Purdue. They have to play Ohio State. All teams that were still contenders here this weekend, the Big Ten race.
Yep.
And the only team has to play only contenders.
They got 2 out of 3 there in Ann Arbor, though. 106 plus.
Yeah, including
that
the Buckeyes.
Some place.
Including the Buckeyes. Well, it's a goal to go. First down for Michigan. Steve Smith has thrown for 3 touchdowns. Here's Smith back, hands off to Ricks. Ricks stacked up near the goal line. Michigan has run the clock down to 3:40 in the ball game. They're leading by 14 points, and they're threatening to put it out of reach right here, it would appear.
They were having some trouble up in the booth here trying to figure out who our Vitalis player of the game is. We've got a first time this year we split.
Well, Steve Smith, and Anthony Carter, which is certainly up to great games. Here's Smith, hands it off to Ricks, touchdown. Lawrence Ricks cracks for the touchdown. That's number 75, Bubba Paris, 275-pounder. Help open the way for Ricks. Here's a little daylight, and he squeezed in to score, and that should put it out of reach for Michigan. It now becomes 23-13 with a try of the point to come. Well, I like, of course, we might as well tell you, I'm voting for Smith and
an old the quarterback here's for a receiver.
You really love those receivers, don't you? Haji Sheik comes in to try for the point after.
We've got our producer down in the truck that can't wait to break this tie.
DJ Dickey. Everybody's going to know who decided it, aren't they? Haji Sheik with the kick. That's the 34th point. Well, these two teams have had the recent history of really piling up the points, so there's 47 points scored already in this game. It's not over with 3 minutes and 15 seconds to go. And the way Smith and Hoynsey move things, we may have more to come. So we're coming down the home stretch in Michigan in the driver's seat. It's the Wolverines 34, the Golden Gophers 13. Now they complete the stadium in shadow. As a matter of fact, they're losing the sunlight for the first time here today. Teddy Watson, number 49, and Kerry Glenn, number 8, are deep as Haji Sheik waits to kick off here for Michigan.
Ali Haji Sheik.
Win number 6 for the Wolverines, 6 out of 8. Three tough ones to go for 1981. Team had been picked to win the national championship, ranked number 1 in the preseason. Upset by Wisconsin at the very beginning, and some feel that really set the stage for this thrilling Big Ten race. Kick is short of Watson. He picks it up to the 10, and Watson is smacked hard there. And down he goes by Carl Tech.
Jim, you know, if you can remember last year, Michigan had a very slow start.
Yep.
And here's our Vitalis player of the game, not the quarterback that my cohort wanted, but my receiver down here, Anthony Carter.
So the Vitalis Most Valuable Player Award, presented each week by ESPN Now, is going to Anthony Carter, a split end for University of Michigan, number 1, a junior from Riviera Beach, Florida, who catches his 28th career touchdown pass today, and we give him our salute. Great play.
And I'll tell you, Jimmy,
I still vote for Smith, but he's the man.
He not only caught that ball so well, the thing is he made Woolfolk's day a lot easier because he's getting that double coverage out there, and he's taking away that support man. And a couple runs that Woolfolk had, these guys are downfield trying to cover Carter.
Well, no question, he draws a crowd, and even so, he was able to catch. There's Jimmy Schimbeckler. After spinning the week.
That's a good picture.
Yep,
good job, cameraman.
He's so happy he's crying. Well, he's been staying with the Salem family, and he's become such a close friend of one of the young Salem sons. Maybe he hates to see his buddy lose that way, too.
I love that shot. Good job, guys.
Great human interest.
There's Anthony Carter. 8 catches, 154 yards.
Isn't that some 2 games in a row he's put together against Minnesota? Well, Minnesota would be glad to see him leave the Big Ten. That's still over a year away. 9 catches for 142 and 2 touchdowns last year, which is his best day ever. So now this becomes his best day ever, 154 yards on 8 catches.
It's an average day at the office.
Okay, Minnesota has Ross and Stroud behind Hoyne. See, I tell you, Points and now has been replaced. Or has he? Nope, he's still in there. He's had some good too.
He sure has.
To the sidelines to Ross. Stays it down. Steps up the 19-yard line. Walter Ross stopped at Jim Herman. Clock rolls. 3 minutes to go in the game.
I have all the respect for Mike Owens. Boy, he's played a very fine game. They sat in that pocket. Great protection by the offensive line. But he has such vision downfield. He doesn't quick go to one receiver. He looks at 2 or 3 guys and makes his decision.
Last week, he was 16 out of 23, 171 yards at Iowa. And he's played almost as well here today. Just his defense could not hold down this great Michigan team. Which you cannot fault Owens for that. Hornsey sticks in there. Hornsey drills it. Got a man open. Cooper can't hold it. Cooper should have had that one right in his hands. Brian Carpenter made the hit.
Now watch Carpenter. Perfect timing here. Cooper has the ball in his hand, but a nice shot. Cooper knowing he's going to get hit because he's right there in the middle of that zone.
Well, Carpenter has made some great plays today, too. He was a starter last year. He's been hurt with an ankle. Got back in the starting lineup as just the last moment today. They were going to let Jerry Burgi start as one halfback and Mary Body the other, but now Carpenter got the call and he's had a great afternoon shadowing Chester Cooper. Cooper's been shut down pretty well. Oh, big blitz here on Hoynsey. Hoynsey trying to get away from Lederon and back to line of scrimmage will be about all, and it'll be fourth down for Minnesota.
And one of the few times that Michigan has been able to put pressure on Hoynsey today.
Clock now rolling with 2 minutes and 8 seconds to go in the game. Some of this great crowd of over 52,000 now filing out of the old brick house. At Minnesota, the new Dome Stadium will be completed here next year. Still remains to be seen whether Minnesota will be playing its home games there, but most people feel they will. Paul Blanchard in the punt. Anthony Carter, our player of the game, back waiting to receive.
Well, I wouldn't have him back there now. I have him halfway to the locker room.
Here's the kick, and Carter's going to field it. Fair catch, called for and taken at the 48 in Michigan territory. So Carter doesn't risk any kind of a run back. Maybe he was told to fair catch it, which is what he does with 1:36 on the clock, and Michigan might well run out the clock here. It'll be an impressive victory for the Wolverines. B.J. Dickey's going to replace Steve Smith. And Smith did have an excellent afternoon, not just in passing, three touchdown passes, but he had the great runs, too, in the option. One of them in early in the second half that led to what probably was the clinching score for Michigan. So Dickey's in there, hassle. And the gift now is off of the sidelines to Drick Rogers. Now Rogers running from tailback up close to midfield. Rogers is a tailback, Castle at fullback, and Dickey the quarterback. And that's probably the unit that's going to run out the clock. 1 minute, 20 seconds to go. Michael Oliverdi made the stop for University of Minnesota. He's a junior. Been some fine performance in this game. Two quarterbacks in Carter especially, but many others. Wolfolk was held out for a while and then came through the fine game. Here's Dickey firing downfield, incomplete. Trying to go deep to Fred Brockington. And Brockington was covered by about three or four players. Good coverage by Kerry Glenn especially.
You know, Jim, a lot of times people in this situation say that Michigan's trying to run up the score on Minnesota by throwing the ball late in the game like this. But my feeling is you can never run up a score as long as you have your second team quarterback in there. Because you always have to have him ready in case something happens to number one. And he's got to get in there and throw under pressure, under fire.
Yeah, I have to give him a chance to play. Minnesota player coming off injured here. A Michigan player, we'll tell you about Marion Boddy, but here's Michigan now, set to go. Third down. Here's B.J. looking. Sacked. Taken down way back for a long loss by John Wood, a junior from Schofield, Wisconsin. Wood gets back to the Michigan 35-yard line. A long loss and still 35 seconds to go in the game. So that brings Don Bracken out once more. Bracken has not had his usual good day punting. Came in here as the fifth leading punter in the country, 45.5. Last week he averaged 56 yards on kick against Northwestern. But today has not hit the ball nearly that well. Been fortunate on some bounces, as always, he'll come down substantially. Gets a good one here. Way back, fair catch is taken back there by Glenn Cardelli. And down around the 20-yard line with 8 seconds to go. So they're going to have time for Hoynes to have one shot at it here. And then the game probably is going to end with Michigan the winner. Right now it's 34-13 for the Wolverines. Well, the upset of the 70s, and there's the old oak and the old little brown jug. The little brown jug left here in 19-3 by Fritz Kreisler and asked it to be returned. Well, the Minnesota team sent a message to Michigan, said, come and get it. So 19-9, they did, won it, and they've been playing for it ever since. It's become the most prized and the most famous football trophy in all the country. Here's Hornsey, maybe the last play of the game, down the middle, incomplete with 3 seconds to go. Going for Walter Ross, we'll have time for one more play. I started to say the old Oaken bucket. Of course, that's a great rivalry, too, isn't it, Purdue and Indiana?
Oh, battle for the bragging rights. But there's another school in Indiana. It's not too bad.
Where would that be?
Well, we won't brag
around
about
South
this year
Bend.
Now.
What's the record at South Bend this year? Pretty
1-8, 2-4. Better things to come.
That's for sure. Out the left is Ruckbecker, to the right, Cooper. Hoynsey, maybe the last play, 3 seconds, barring a penalty here. Now, this is a second and 79. He's going to Cooper. Going for Cooper, and it is incomplete. Time is out on the clock. That's it. The ball game is over. And the University of Michigan, impressive today, giving Bo Schembechler victory number 160 in his outstanding career. And for Michigan, 6-2, 4-2 in the Big Ten. And they're still very much in the hunt to defend their championship. Bo Schembechler going out to congratulate some of the Minnesota players. There's Joe Salem, one of the two coaches. And we told you throughout, they're very close, very good friends. And now that the battle is over, they can go back to that friendship. Joe's telling Bo, well, congratulations, you played a great game, and
Michigan Replay 1981 with Bo Schembechler and Jim Brandstatter. Brought to you by the General Motors Corporation and its Pontiac and General Motors Parts Division. By the General Tire and Rubber Company. And by Budweiser.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Michigan Replay. This week we talk about a victory, Michigan 34, Minnesota 13. It was the first of the big Final Four that you had mentioned the last time around. You said you had to win those Final Four. They were the best teams in the conference at that time, and you got it big.
Well, that's right, Jim, and it was a great victory for us, really. Keeps us in the race. We beat a good football team. We kept the little brown jug. It was a great afternoon every way you can figure.
I don't know when I've ever seen a game where people could tell exactly what you were going to do, at least from the start, because it looked to me like you wanted to go to Anthony Carter a lot and give the ball to Stanley Edwards on the ground a lot.
Well, what we wanted to do was to establish the fact that we were not going to let him overload on the run. And on their defense, you got to hit it quick because they're playing a lot of gap defense and a lot of people up on the line. So we wanted to feature Stanley early and to go to Anthony whenever they gave a single coverage.
And you didn't waste any time going to Anthony.
So we went to him right away, and we started working on the outside to him and forcing them to put the extra man out. What we thought would happen, I think did happen, they started to double cover in the second half, and then we went to the run. This is Edwards on the counter play in the first drive. We took the ball. They had the ball, and then we forced a kick and went down and got into position for a field goal. And kicked Holly Hodges, she kicked the field goal, and we went ahead 3-0.
It's nice to see one of those go through, too.
Oh, yeah. This was probably my fault. Decided to go after a punt. And roughed the kicker at about the 5-yard line. And so that gave them a first down and gave them an opportunity to move with the football. I wish they hadn't done that. I wish I had gone for the return, but that's one of those things. You always run the risk of doing that when you go after the ball.
And yet the defense bend a little bit, but didn't break.
The original plan of the Minnesota team was to run on us, and they weren't as successful as they had hoped they'd be. They did get in position to attempt this field goal, but it wasn't good, and so we're still leading 3-0. We come right back and go to Anthony again. This time you can see the second guy coming into the picture. They're starting to try to get the extra man out on him.
Isn't it suicide, though, to try to single cover?
Well, let's hope the people continue to do that, Jim. I think the big thing with Anthony is just to get the ball there. He'll run the cuts and he'll get open. And we come down in here and on the 10-yard line, go to Stanley on a flood pass and hit him for a touchdown. And now we go up 10-0.
You must have seen that play open, too, all week long, because Stanley was wide open. You hit him for two TDs.
We went to him twice on exactly the same play. Here's the second quarter now, and Hohenese, their fine quarterback, throws the ball extremely well, Jim, and hit a lot of passes on us. But fortunately, not enough to score a lot of points. Here's a third and goal for them, and they roll out, and we had the receivers covered, but we failed to contain the quarterback, which you have to do on the goal line. And he ends up running the 4 yards for the touchdown that puts them right back in the game and makes the score 10-7. Once again, they're back to pass, and here was a great interception by Keith Bostic. Went up over the top, never touched the receiver, and intercepted the ball, and that stops the drive, and that was very key.
Because you really weren't in control at that point.
No. Here's a 3rd and 18 over the middle to Vince Bean for the first down by a couple of yards, and that is a key third down play, no question about it. Here's the option play with Steve Smith. He comes out to the outside. I think they misjudged his speed a little bit here, Jim. And then he conveniently had the ball knocked out of his hands. Fortunately for us, it went out of bounds. But at least he got the first down. Now, here's an interesting play, Jim. We had a first down on the 1-yard line. First down on the one, and we went to a pass for a touchdown.
I tell you, you're just not the old coach I knew.
Just a wild, crazy coaching here. One pass for first down on the one. So here we are in the third quarter now, and this is an interference penalty against Minnesota on a flood pass to Stanley Edwards in the flat. We come out and run the option pass, and here is a great catch by Vince Bean of a ball along the sidelines. Isn't that beautiful control, and made the catch and got us in position again.
Vincent Bean really has developed into a fine receiver.
He's a good receiver. He's a very, very fine receiver. Ali Haji Sheik kicks another field goal, and we go ahead 20-7. Minnesota comes back, are throwing extremely well. Now look at this. Here's a blitz, Jim, and we had him sacked back there. And all of a sudden, he's running right up the middle. We miss a tackle there, and they get a first down out of a play when we should have had him sacked for a 10-yard loss. That's the kind of thing that kind of upsetting there on the sideline, you know. They tipped another field goal, and it's wide. And so the score remains 20-7. Minnesota again with the ball here. They run off-tackle play and goes up the middle for a good game. And this game is still, you know, anybody's ball game right now.
They did control the ball on you some, and I know that bothers you.
Well, too much. They had 31 minutes, start 29, to tell you the truth. Here's a fourth and three, and they throw the ball here incomplete, and we take over.
That's a big play, too, because, again, they're pushing close. A touchdown gets them within a touchdown of actually going ahead.
No question about it. It'd been that's right. If two touchdowns would have won the game for them. Here's Butch breaking out. In the second half, when they went to more coverage on Anthony, and we went to the run a little bit more, I thought Butch ran extremely hard, and that really helped us. Here's a third and four, and we go up over the top to Anthony, and I watch his catch. It's a sensational catch, great control with his feet, and we end up getting a touchdown out of it.
He continues to amaze me. Does he continue to amaze you?
Every time I see him play. He's a lot of fun to watch play. He certainly is. Now we're leading 27-7. They come over the middle and hit a pass to get into our territory and begin to move. Here's a third and six. And he hits the fullback over the middle here. Coming out of the backfield and gets another first down.
They went to their backs a lot.
Now watch this play, Jim. This is their second touchdown. Looked to me like he pushed our guy a little bit there, but Marion Boddy tips the ball and they catch it and run in for a touchdown.
No flag.
And no, no flag on that. But you know, nevertheless, that's one of those things. You hate to see a team score with a play like that, but that's the way it goes. Someday we'll get some of those. We come back and finally get possession, and Larry Rick's in at tailback for us now and begin a drive that ends up on this play on the one-yard line with Rick's diving in for the touchdown. And this makes the score 34-13 in our favor.
And I think the key, too, the final drive, you really stuck it on the ground and put it away.
Well, what we wanted to do was to, control the football get good field position if we had to turn it over, because at that time we were leading by 14 points, and it was pretty safe, but it's never completely safe.
But in that sense, you hadn't done that a lot this year. When the game, you had the chance to really put it away, put the other team out of it, you really haven't done that, but this game you did.
Well, I think so. And, you know, the one thing about our team, if we can get the ball, I think our offense can move it, you know. I think against most of the teams that we play, I think we can move the football. But you got to have the ball to do it. And, you know, everybody's moving the football and controlling a little bit, and everybody's throwing control passing attacks and getting first downs and everything. It's kind of a different game. There isn't a lot of physical defense and physical running offenses that control the ball and pick up first downs. They're all doing it with the passing game.
Coming up next, we'll take a look at an invasion of the Big Ten by an idea, a quick remedy. We'll be right back. Some people are saying that the Big Ten is getting Pac-10-ized, meaning there's an overabundance of junior college players coming into the Big Ten where they hadn't before. And a lot of them are very successful, like Hohensee from Minnesota, Gunn and Laufenberg from Indiana, and Illinois, your next opponent, has a ton of them. What's happening? Are we becoming a Pac-10 in the Big Ten?
Well, I'm not so sure the Pac-10, you know, does as much of that. Southern Cal does some, but not a lot. I think the same thing is true of UCLA. I think the basis of a program has to be freshmen. I don't think you build a real firm base unless you do recruit that way. But when you do have a basic weakness in some area of your personnel, it is a good idea to go to the junior colleges for a particular purpose. I don't think you build an entire team from it, but I do think that you can get help.
When you hear of junior college transfers, the immediate thought is, well, what about their grades? You know, and that seems to be the general thought the first time you hear about it because they've had a bad reputation.
Well, I think that in some cases, non-qualified players that can't get grant and aid help as freshmen do go to junior colleges. Now, out on the West Coast, that's not always true. There are a lot of good students that go to junior colleges, and so those youngsters are usually pretty well-qualified students. I don't think that we ought to think in terms that the junior college kid is a dumb kid. The only problem is that when they transfer in after 2 years at junior college, how long is it going to take them to get a degree from the university they transferred to? Because in most cases, a lot of the transferred work is not acceptable as far as degree requirements.
A lot of people say it's a quick remedy, immediate help. Why don't you do it more? And a lot of other successful coaches around the country have not done it, other than, say, John Robinson at USC. But, you know, Woody Hayes, I don't believe, did it, and Earl Bruce doesn't do it. Joe Paterno doesn't do
it. Well, yeah, you're talking about the schools that have been successful. Ohio State, Michigan, Penn State, Notre Dame. They will not play with a lot of junior college players. I'm not saying we wouldn't go to the junior college, because we may in terms of getting some immediate help. But I think if I were a youngster, I'd want to go into a program where I go in as a freshman, I know all the players ahead of me, who I have to compete against in order to win a position. I have to fend off the freshmen when they come in, if there's a great prospect coming in that area. But I'd hate like heck to be coming in there, going into my junior year, and all of a sudden some 20-year-old junior comes in and that hasn't gone through the 2 years that I have in preparation to play. And starts ahead of them.
That makes recruiting along the line a little tougher, too, because the word filters down that you might have as a junior, not the same chance you had as a freshman.
Right.
Another game is coming up for Michigan, and it is, again, a must-win situation. We'll be right back with our Michigan Replay scouting report on the Fighting Illini.
For some time now, General Motors has been talking with people who know cars.
I'm Ed Dame, General Manager, Avis Car Leasing. Last year, my company bought more GM cars for lease to our customers than any other make.
But what about average GM car buyers? When they replace the GM car they bought new with another new car, 70% buy GM again. In the U.S., no other major car company, foreign or domestic, comes close. See a GM dealer for your next car. Pontiac. Now the excitement begins.
Last year's Illinois team rewrote the aerial section of the Big Ten record book. This year's team is proving that last year's fancy passing was no passing fancy. Junior quarterback Tony Eason's been amazingly consistent through the Big Ten season, over 300 yards in each of the first five games. He's completed 62% of his passes, throwing an average of 35 times a game. 2,071 yards through seven games led the nation. His favorite targets are split end Mike Martin and flanker Oliver Williams. Martin was a top receiver a year ago, and he's been Illinois' most consistent pass catcher in 1981. He's one of four players who have caught more than 20 passes, and he's averaging more than 20 yards per catch. Oliver Williams is a junior college transfer who's rapidly developed into one of the Big Ten's best. His 86-yard play in the homecoming victory over Wisconsin is the longest in the Big Ten this year. Williams can catch him in traffic and in one-on-one situations. Illinois' defense has been overshadowed by the O, but through seven games, it ranked second in the Big Ten overall. Linebacker Kelvin Atkins will rank right at the top before he's through. Number 84 will become the school record holder in tackles for loss before the season ends. At 6'3 and 225, he plays the run and the pass equally well, and he's one of the hardest hitters on the Illinois team. The season-long tackling leader is senior linebacker Jack Squirek, 71 stops through seven games. He plays the middle in Illinois' 4-3 alignment, and Squirek is one of the most consistent of the Illini defenders. The 1981 version of the Fighting Illini, a wide-open offense and a capable defense, have added up to a team that's still in contention for a Big Ten championship. For Michigan Replay, this is Dan Rome.
The Illini come into the game against Michigan with successive wins over Wisconsin and Iowa, something you couldn't do. Mm-hmm. Why is it that you always get them when they're on a roll?
Well, you know, I don't know whether we get them on a roll. We got them on a roll last year. But Illinois is a much improved team over last year. They're still throwing the ball as well. But I think they've improved their defense a lot. You know, we scored 45 points on them last year. And I think their defense is much better this year, Jim. So they're definitely in contention. My original statement a week ago was that the four teams that we play are playing the best football in the conference today. And so we have to figure Illinois is one of the top teams, and we've got to beat Illinois. It's a week-to-week thing, but we're still in the race, and we've got a great shot if we could win these next three.
It never gets any easier, and coming up next, we'll have a special Michigan Replay tribute and salute to a very good friend, Bob Uford, who passed away this week.
Ufer, Michigan broadcaster. That's how we knew him, and why not? For 36 seasons, we listened to him in his cotton-thick and maize-and-blue heart through 362 straight games. His style was pure blue. When Michigan won, he reveled with memories of fielding H. Yost. When they lost, it was as if the world had come to an end. But Bob Ufer was more than a broadcaster. He was a Michigan graduate, a former track All-American, and world record holder in the 440. A devoted family man and father of seven kids, he never had to regret a moment of life. His love of life and Michigan spilled over into everything he did. He knew the players and liked them as young men. And appropriately, one of his greatest moments came in 1976, as he was the MC at a rally for a former player, the then President Gerald Ford.
President Ford, I would like to present you with this gift on behalf of the entire Michigan family from all over the world. Today, your football team is number one in the country. You are the number one citizen in the world, and you will continue to be number one November 2nd, and it's all right here.
So often, a person that's loved and respected by so many doesn't get their proper recognition until they're gone. Luckily and appropriately, the fans and the university he loved so much paid him back in a small way at halftime of this year's Iowa game. And it was all Bob Ufer would have asked for.
And I want to ask you two questions. Number one, down deep in your heart, what school has the finest football tradition in the country today? Second question, who's the number one football coach in the country today?
three blasts on the four yard
He was a very, very special man, and I'm sure that you feel, as I think we all do, part of the Michigan family, that he will never be replaced.
No, he was a great personal friend of mine and a great institution in Michigan football, and his memory will live on forever, anywhere Michigan football is played. I'm sure the memory of Bob Eufer will be there, and somewhere... as he used to say, up there in that football Valhalla, Bob Eufer will be looking down every Saturday to see how Michigan play.
And I think, too, every college should have a Bob Eufer. Michigan, I think, was very, very lucky to have him.
His loyalty was beyond anything. He'd never criticize a player. I've never heard him criticize a coach. He believed in everything that we were doing, and he loved college football because the things that college football represented were the things that he believed in. Discipline, hard work, dedication, tremendous loyalty, all of those things typified Bob Eufer, and that's why he was so attracted to Michigan football.
Well, we certainly will miss him. He will never, ever be replaced. Thank you all very much for joining us this week, and please join us next week. We'll take a look at another critical game, this time against Illinois.
Michigan Replay has been brought to you by the General Motors Corporation and its Pontiac and General Motors Parts Division. By the General Tire and Rubber Company. And by Budweiser.